Revolt Against the Modern World by Julie Savola. Part 1. The World of Tradition. The skillful masters of the Tao in old times, with a subtle and exquisite penetration, comprehended its mysteries and were deep, also, so as to elude men's knowledge. Shrinking, looked they like those who wade through a stream in winter, resolute, like those who are afraid of all around them, evanescent like ice that is melting away, unpretentious like wood that has not been fashioned into anything, vacant like a valley, and a dull like muddy water. Who can make the muddy water clear? Who can secure the condition of rest? They who preserve this method of the Tao do not wish to be full of themselves. It is for their not being full of themselves that they can afford to seem worn and not appear to be new and complete. Tao Te Ching. Chapter 1. The Beginning. In order to understand both the spirit of tradition and its antithesis, modern civilization, it is necessary to begin with the fundamental doctrine of the two natures. According to this doctrine, there is a physical order of things and a metaphysical one. There is a mortal nature and an immortal one. There is the superior realm of being and the inferior realm of becoming. Generally speaking, there is a visible and tangible dimension and, prior to and beyond it, an invisible and intangible dimension that is the support, the source, and true life of the former. Anywhere in the world of tradition, both East and West, and in one form or another, this knowledge, not just a mere theory, has always been present as an unshakable axis around which everything revolved. Let me emphasize the fact that it was knowledge and not theory. As difficult as it may be for our contemporaries to understand this, we must start from the idea that the man of tradition was aware of the existence of a dimension of being much wider than what our contemporaries experience and call reality. Now it is, after all, reality is understood only as something strictly encompassed within the world of physical bodies located in space and time. Certainly, there are those who believe in something beyond the realm of phenomena. When these people admit the existence of something else, however, they are always led to this conclusion by a scientific hypothesis or law, or by a speculative idea, or by a religious dogma. They cannot escape such an intellectual limitation. Through his practical and immediate experiences, modern man, no matter how deep his materialistic or spiritual beliefs may be, develops an understanding of reality only in relation to the world of physical bodies and always under the influence of his direct and immediate experiences. This is the real materialism for which our contemporaries should be reproached. All the other versions of materialism that are formulated in scientific or in philosophical terms are only secondary phenomena. The worst type of materialism, therefore, is not a matter of an opinion or of a theory, but it consists in the fact that man's experience no longer extends to non-physical realities. Thus, the majority of the intellectual revolts against materialistic views are only vain reactions against the latest peripheral effects stemming from remote and deeper causes. These causes, incidentally, arose in a different historical context from the one in which the theories were formulated. The experience of traditional man used to reach well beyond these limits, as in the case of some so-called primitive people, among whom we still find today a faint echo of spiritual powers from ancient times. In traditional societies, the invisible was an element as real, if not more real, than the data provided by the physical senses. Every aspect of the individual and of the social life of the people belonging to these societies was influenced by this experience. On the one hand, from the perspective of tradition, what today is usually referred to as reality was only a species of a much wider genus. On the other hand, invisible realities were not automatically equated with the supernatural. Traditionally speaking, the notion of nature did not correspond merely to the world of bodies and of visible forms, the objective research of contemporary secularized science, but on the contrary, it corresponded essentially to part of an invisible reality. The ancients had the sense of a dark netherworld, populated by obscure and ambiguous forces of every kind, the demonic soul of nature, which is the essential substratum of all nature's forms and energies, that was opposed to the superrational and sidereal brightness of a higher region. Moreover, the term nature traditionally included everything that is merely human, since what is human cannot escape birth and death, impermanence, dependence, and transformation, all of which characterize the inferior region. By definition, that which is has nothing to do with human and temporal affairs or situations, as in the saying, the race of men is one thing, and the race of the gods is quite another. This saying retains its validity even though people once thought that the reference to a superior, otherworldly domain could effectively lead the integration and the purification of the human element in the direction of the non-human dimension. Only the non-human dimension constituted the essence and the goal of any truly traditional civilization. The world of being and the world of becoming affect things, demons, and men. Every hypostatic representation of these two regions, whether expressed in astral, mythological, theological, or religious terms, reminded traditional man of the existence of the two states. It also represented a symbol to be resolved into an inner experience, or at least in the foreboding of an inner experience. Thus, in Hindu, and especially in Buddhist tradition, the idea of samsara, the current that dominates and carries away every form of the inferior world, refers to an understanding of life as blind yearning and as an irrational identification with impermanent aggregates. Likewise, Hellenism saw nature as the embodiment of the eternal state of deprivation of those realities that, by virtue of having their own principle and cause outside of themselves, flow and run away indefinitely. In their becoming, these realities reveal a primordial and radical lack of direction and purpose and a perennial limitation. According to these traditions, matter and becoming express the reality that acts in a being as an obscure necessity or as an irrepressible indetermination, or as the inability to acquire a perfect form and to possess itself in a law. Christian scholastic theology shared similar views, since it considered the root of every unredeemed nature in terms of cupiditas and of impetitus animus. In different ways, the man of tradition found in the experience of covetous identification, which obscures and impairs being, the secret cause of his existential predicament. The incessant becoming and the perennial instability and contingency of the inferior region appeared to the man of tradition as the cosmic and symbolic materialization of that predicament. On the other hand, the experience of asceticism was regarded as the path leading to the other region, or to the world of being, or to what is no longer physical but metaphysical. Asceticism traditionally consisted in values such as mastery over oneself, self-discipline, autonomy, and the leading of a unified life. By unified life, I mean an existence that does not need to be spent in search of other things or people in order to be complete and justified. The traditional representations of this other region were solar symbols, heavenly regions, beings made of light or fire, islands, and mountain peaks. These were the two natures. Tradition conceived the possibility of being born in either one, and also of the possibility of going from one birth to another, according to the saying, "A man is a mortal god, and a god is an immortal man." The world of tradition knew these two great poles of existence, as well as the paths leading from one to the other. Tradition knew the existence of the physical world and the totality of the forms, whether visible or underground, whether human or subhuman and demonic, of aprasya, a world beyond this world. According to tradition, the former is the fall of the latter, and the latter represents the liberation of the former. The traditional world believed spirituality to be something beyond life and death. It held that mere physical existence, or living, is meaningless unless it approximates the higher world or that which is more than life, and unless one's highest ambition consists in participating in aprasya and in obtaining an active and final liberation from the bond represented by the human condition. According to tradition, every authority is fraudulent, every law is unjust and barbarous, every institution is vain and ephemeral unless they are ordained to the superior principle of being, and unless they are derived from above and oriented upward. The traditional world knew divine kingship. It knew the bridge between the two worlds, namely, initiation. It knew the two great ways of approach to the transcendent, namely, heroic action and contemplation. It knew the mediation, namely, rites and faithfulness. It knew the social foundation, namely, the traditional law and the caste system. And it knew the political oath symbol, namely, the empire. These are the foundations of the traditional hierarchy and civilization that have been completely wiped out by the victorious anthropocentric civilization of our contemporaries. Chapter 2. Regality. Every traditional civilization is characterized by the presence of beings who, by virtue of their innate or acquired superiority over the human condition, embody within the temporal order the living and efficacious presence of a power that comes from above. One of these types of beings is the pontifex, according to the inner meaning of the word and according to the original value of the function that he exercised. Pontifex means builder of bridges or of paths, ponds, in ancient times also meant path, connecting the natural and the supernatural dimensions. Moreover, the pontifex was traditionally identified with the king Rex. Servius, the late 4th century commentator on Virgil's works, writes, "The custom of our ancestors was that the king should also be pontifex and priest. A saying of the Nordic tradition reads, "May your leader be our bridge." Thus, real monarchs were the steadfast personification of the life beyond ordinary life, beneficial spiritual influences used to radiate upon the world of mortal beings from the mere presence of such men, from their pontifical mediation, from the power of the rites that were rendered efficacious by their power, and from the institutions of which they were the center. These influences permeated people's thoughts, intentions, and actions, ordering every aspect of their lives and constituting a fit foundation for luminous, spiritual realizations. These influences also made propitious the general conditions for prosperity, health, and good fortune. In the world of tradition, the most important foundation of the authority and of the right eos, of kings and chiefs, and the reason why they were obeyed, feared, and venerated, was essentially a transcendent and non-human quality. This quality was not artificial, but a powerful reality to be feared. The more people acknowledged the ontological rank of what was prior and superior to the visible and temporal dimension, the more such beings were invested with a natural and absolute sovereign power. Traditional civilizations, unlike those of decadent and later times, completely ignored the merely political dimension of supreme authority, as well as the idea that the roots of authority lay in mere strength, violence, or natural and secular qualities such as intelligence, wisdom, physical courage, and a minute concern for the collective material well-being. The roots of authority, on the contrary, always had a metaphysical character. Likewise, the idea that the power to govern is conferred on the chief by those whom he rules, and that his authority is the expression of the community and therefore subject to its decrees, was foreign to tradition. It is Zeus who bestows the themist on kings of divine origin, whereby themas, or law from above, is very different from what constitutes nomos, which is the political law of the community. The root of every temporal power was spiritual authority, which was almost a divine nature disguised in human form. According to an Indo-European view, the ruler is not a mere mortal, but rather a great deity standing in the form of a man. The Egyptian pharaoh was believed to be the manifestation of Ra or of Horus. The kings of Aulo and of Rome were supposed to be the incarnations of Zeus. The Assyrian kings of all, the Persian shahs, of the god of light. The Nordic Germanic princes were believed to derive from the race of Teus, of Odin, and of the Asses. And the Greek kings of the Dorichean cycle were called Dautrepses or Diogenes in reference to their divine origin. Beyond the variety of mythical and sacred expressions, the recurrent view of kingship is expressed in terms of an immanent transcendence that is present and active in thee. The king, who was believed to be a sacred being and not a man, by virtue of his being, was already the center and the apex of the community. In him was also the supernatural strength that made his ritual actions efficacious. In these actions, people could recognize the earthly counterpart of supernatural ruling, as well as the supernatural support of life in the world of tradition. For this reason, kingship was the supreme form of government and was believed to be in the natural order of things. It did not need physical strength to assert itself, and when it did, it was only sporadically. It imposed itself mainly and irresistibly through the spirit. In an ancient Indo-Aryan text it is written, "The dignity a god enjoys on earth is splendid, but hard to achieve for the weak. Only he who sets his soul on this objective is worthy to become a king." The ruler appears as a follower of the discipline that is practiced by those who are gods among men. In tradition, kingship was often associated with the solar symbol. In the king, people saw the same glory and victory proper to the sun and to the light, the symbols of the superior nature, which every morning overcome darkness. Every day he rises on Horus' throne, as king of the living, just like his father Ra the sun. And also, "I have decreed that you must eternally rise as king of the north and of the south on the seat of Horus, like the sun." These sayings from the ancient Egyptian royal tradition bear a striking similarity to the sayings of the Persian tradition, in which the king is believed to be of the same stock as the gods. He has the same throne of Mithras and he rises with the sun. He is called Praetica Psiderum and Lord of Peace, Salvation of Mankind, Eternal Man, Winner who rises in company of the sun. In ancient prose, the consecrating formula was, "Thou art power, the force of victory, and immortal. Made of gold, thou rise, Aton, together with Indra and with the sun." In the Indo-Aryan tradition, in reference to Rohita, who is the conquering force and who personifies an aspect of the radiance of the divine fire, Aindia, we find, by coming forward, he Aindia has created kingship in this world. He has conferred on you Rohita majesty and victory over your enemies. In some ancient Roman representations, the god soul of Sun presents the emperor with a sphere, which is the symbol of universal dominion. Also, the expression sol conservator and sol dominus Romani imperio, which are employed to describe room stability and ruling power, refer to the brightness of the sun. The last Roman profession of faith was solar. Since the last representative of the ancient Roman tradition, the Emperor Julian consecrated his dynasty, his birth, and royal condition to the brightness of the sun, which he considered to be a spiritual force radiating from the higher worlds. A reflection of the solar symbol was preserved up to the time of Ghibelline emperors. One may still speak of a Deitas Solis in reference to Frederick II of Hohenschaffen. This solar glory or victory in reference to kingship was not reduced to a mere symbol, but rather denoted a metaphysical reality. Eventually it came to be identified with a non-human operating force, which the king did not possess in and by himself. One of the most characteristic symbolic expressions of this idea comes from the Zoroastrian tradition, where in the H4NO, the glory that the king possesses is a supernatural fire characterizing heavenly, and especially solar, entities that allows the king to partake of immortality and that gives him witness through victory. This victory must be understood in such a way that the two meanings, the first mystical, the second military material, are not mutually exclusive but rather complementary. Among non-Persian people, this H4NO was later confused with fate. With this meaning, it reappeared in the Roman tradition in the form of the royal fate that the Caesars retransmitted to each other, and in which the people reckoned as an active, triumphal undertaking of the personified destiny of the city, determined by the ritual of their appointment. The Roman regal attribute Felix must be referred to this context and to the possession of an extranormal virtus. In the Vedic tradition, we find a parallel notion. Anivesvanara is conceived as a spiritual fire that leads the conquering kings to victory. In ancient Egypt, the king was not called merely Horus, but Fighting Horus or Ahad, to designate the victorious and glorious character of the solar principle present in the monarch. The Egyptian pharaoh, who was believed to descend from the gods, was enthroned as one of them, and later on in his life he was periodically reconfirmed in his role through rituals that reproduced the victory of the solar god Horus over Typhon Set, a demon from the netherworld. These rites were thought to have such a power as to evoke the force and the life that supernaturally encompassed the king's person. The hieroglyphic for force, as, is the scepter handled by gods and kings alike. In the Ulu's test, the scepter is portrayed as the zigzag bolt of lightning. The regal force thus appears as a manifestation of the dazzling heavenly force. The combination of signs represented the concept of life force, Einchis, form a word for fiery milk, which is the nourishment of the immortals. This word is not without relation to Aries, the divine flame, at times life-giving, at other times dangerously destructive, which crowns the head of the Egyptian king in the shape of a serpent. In this traditional formulation, the various elements converge in the idea of a non-terrestrial power, fluid sa. This power consecrates and gives witness to the solar, triumphant nature of the king, and gushes forth from one king to the other, thus guaranteeing the uninterrupted and golden sequence in the divine lineage, which is legitimately appointed to the task of Regair. Interestingly enough, the theme of glory as a divine attribute is found even in Christianity, and according to mystical theology, the beatific vision takes place within the glory of God. Christian iconography used to portray this glory as a halo around the person's head, thus visibly representing the meaning of the Egyptian Aureus and of the glowing crown of the Persian and Roman solar kings. According to a Far Eastern tradition, the king, as a son of heaven who is believed to have unhuman origins, enjoys the mandate of heaven, Tianming, which implies the idea of a real and supernatural force. This force that comes from heaven, according to Lao Tzu, acts without acting, wei wei wei, through an immaterial presence, or by virtue of just being present. It is as invisible as the wind, and yet its actions are as ineluctable as the forces of nature. When this power is unleashed, the forces of common men, according to Meng Tzu, bend under it as blades of grass under the wind. Concerning wei wei, a text says, by its thickness and substantiality, sincerity equals earth, and by its height and splendor it equals heaven. Its extent and duration are without limit. He who possesses the sincerity, without showing himself, he will shine forth. Without moving, he will renovate others. Without acting, he will perfect them. Only such a man is able to harmonize the opposing strands of human society, to establish and to maintain moral order in the country. Established in this force or virtue, the Chinese monarch Wang performed the supreme role of a center or a third power between heaven and earth. The common assumption was that the fortunes and misfortunes of the kingdom, as well as the moral qualities of his subjects, It is the virtue in relation to the being of the monarch, and not his actions, that carries positive or negative influences on them, secretly dependent on the monarch's behavior. The central role exercised by the king presupposed that the king maintained the aforesaid triumphal inner way of being. In this context, the meaning of the famous saying, immutability in the middle, may correspond to the doctrine according to which, in the immutability of the middle, the virtue of heaven is manifested. If this principle is implemented as a general rule, nothing could have changed the arranged course of human events or those of the state. In general, the fact that the king's or chief's primary and essential function consisted in performing those ritual and sacrificial actions that constituted the center of gravity of life is a recurrent idea in a vast cycle of traditional civilizations, from pre-Columbian Peru to the Far East, and including Greek and Roman cities. This idea confirms the inseparability of royal office from priestly or pontifical office. According to Aristotle, the kings enjoy their office by virtue of being the officiating priests at their community's worship. The first duty of the Spartan kings was to perform sacrifices, and the same could be said about the first kings of Rome and of many rulers during the imperial period. The king, empowered with a non-terrestrial force with its roots in something that is more than life, naturally appeared as one who could eminently actualize the power of the rites and opened the way leading to the superior world. Thus, in those traditional forms of civilization in which there was a separate priestly class, the king, because of his original dignity and function, belonged to this class and was its true leader. In addition to early Rome, this situation was found both in ancient Egypt. In order to make the rites efficacious, the pharaoh repeated daily the prayer that was believed to renew the divine force in his person, and in Iran, where, as Xenophon recalls, the king, who according to his function was considered the image of the god of light on earth, belonged to the caste of Magi and was its leader. On the other hand, if among certain people there was the custom of deposing and even of killing the chief when an accident or a catastrophe occurred, for this seemed to signify a decrease in the mystical force of good fortune that gave one the right to be chief, this custom gives witness to the same order of ideas, although in the form of a superstitious degeneration. In the Nordic racial stocks up to the time of the Goths, and notwithstanding the principle of royal sacredness, the king was considered as an esses and as a demigod who wins in battle thanks to the power of his good fortune, and an inauspicious event was understood not so much as the absence of the mystical power of fortune abiding in the king, but rather as the consequence of something that the king, as a mortal man, had done, thus compromising the objective effectiveness of his power. It was believed, for instance, that the consequence for failing to implement the fundamental Arian virtue of always telling the truth, and thus being stained by lies, caused the lori, or the mystical efficacious virtue, to abandon the ancient Iranian king, Emir. All the way up to the Carolingian Middle Ages and within Christianity itself, local councils of bishops were at times summoned in order to investigate what misdeed perpetrated by a representative of the temporal or ecclesiastical authority could have caused a given calamity. These are the last echoes of the above-mentioned idea. The monarch was required to retain the symbolic and solar dignity of invictus, sol invictus, as well as the state of inner equilibrium that corresponds to the Chinese notion of immutability in the middle, otherwise the force and its prerogative would be transferred to another person who could prove worthy of it. I will mention in this context a case in which the concept of victory became a focal point of various meanings. There is an interesting ancient saga of Nemus, king of the woods, whose royal and priestly office was supposed to be conferred on the person capable of catching him by surprise and slaying him. J.G. Fraser tracked now numerous traditions of the same kind all over the world. In this context, the physical combat aspect of the trial, if it had to occur, is only the materialistic transposition of some higher meaning, and it must be related to the general view of divine judgments, more on which later. Concerning the deepest meaning of the legend of Nemus King Priest, it must be remembered that according to tradition, only a fugitive slave, esoterically speaking, a being who had become free from the bonds of his lower nature, armed with a branch tom off a sacred oak, had the right to compete with the Rex Nemerensis, King of the Woods. The oak is the equivalent of the tree of the world, which in other traditions is frequently adopted as a symbol designating the primordial life force and the power of victory. This means that only a being who has succeeded in a potent of this force may aspire to take the place of the Rex Nemerensis. Concerning this office, it must be observed that the oak in the woods, of which Nemus priest king was Rex, were related to Diana. In turn, Diana was the bride of the king of the woods. In some ancient, Eastern Mediterranean traditions, the great goddesses were often symbolized by sacred trees. From the Hellenic myth of the Hesperides, to the Nordic myth of the goddess Elenid, and to the Gallic myth of Mogmel, which was the residence of very beautiful goddesses and of the Tree of Victory, it is possible to notice traditional symbolic connections between women or goddesses, forces of life, immortality, wisdom, and trees. Concerning the Rex Nemerensis, we can recognize in the symbols employed that the notion of kingship derives from having married or possessed the mystical force of life, of transcendent wisdom and immortality that is personified both by the goddess and by the tree. Nemesaga, therefore, incorporates the general symbol, which is found in many other myths and traditional legends, of a winner or of a hero who possesses a woman or a goddess. The goddess appears in other traditions either as a guardian of the fruits of immortality, see the female figures in relation to the Symbolica tree in the myths of Heracles, Jason, Gilgamesh, and so on, or as a personification of the occult force of the world, of life and of non-human knowledge, or as the embodiment of the principle of sovereignty, the knight or the unknown hero of the legend, who becomes king after taking as his bride a mysterious princess. Some of the ancient traditions about a female source of royal power may also be interpreted in this fashion. Their meaning, in that case, is exactly opposite to gynecocris, which will be discussed later. As far as the tree is concerned, interestingly enough, even in some medieval legends it is related to the imperial ideal. The last emperor, before dying, will hang the scepter, the crown, and the shield in a dry tree, which is usually located in the Symbolica region of Prestonjan, just like the dying Roland hung his unbreakable sword in the tree. This is yet another convergence of Symbolica contents, for Fraser has shown the relationship existing between the branch that the fugitive slave must break off Nemus' sacred oak in order to fight with Nemus' king and the branch Aeneas carried to descend, while alive, into the invisible dimension. One of the gifts that Emperor Frederick to receive from the mysterious Prestonjan was a ring that renders invisible and victorious the one who wears it. Invisibility, in this context, refers to the access to the invisible realm and to the achievement of immortality. In Greek traditions, the hero's invisibility is often synonymous with his becoming immortal. This was the case of Siegfried in the Nibelungen 6, who through the same symbolic virtue of becoming invisible, subjugates and marries the divine woman Brynhild, just like Siegfried in the Sigrifuma 4-6, is the one who bestows on the heroes who awakened her the formulas of wisdom and of victory contained in the runes. Remnants of traditions, in which we find the themes contained in the ancient saga of the King of the Woods, last until shortly beyond the end of the Middle Ages. They are always associated with the old idea, according to which a legitimate king is capable of manifesting in specific, concrete, and almost experimental ways, the signs of his supernatural nature. The following is just one example. Prior to the Hundred Years' War, Venice asked Philip of Valois to demonstrate his actual right to be king in one of the following ways. The first way, victory over a contender whom Philip was expected to fight to the death in an enclosed area, reminds us of the Rex Nemerensis and of the mystical testimony inherent in every victory. As far as the other examples are concerned, we read in a text dating back to those times, if Philip of Valois was, as he affirms, the true king of France, let him prove the fact by exposing himself to hungry lions, for lions never attack a true king, or let him perform the miraculous healing of the sick, as all other true kings are wont to do. If he should fail, he would own himself to be unworthy of the kingdom. A supernatural power, manifested through a victory or through a thaumaturgical virtue, even in times like Philip's, which are no longer primordial times, is thus inseparably connected with the traditional idea of real and legitimate kingship. Aside from the factual adequacy of single individuals to the principle and to the function of kingship, what remains is the view that what has led people to venerate so many kings were mainly the divine virtues and powers, which descended on the kings alone, and not on other men as well. Joseph de Maistre wrote, God makes kings in the literal sense. He prepares royal races, maturing them under a cloud which conceals their origin. They appear at length crowned with glory and honor, they take their places, and this is the most certain sign of their legitimacy. The truth is that they arise as it were of themselves, without violence on their part, and without marked deliberation on the other. It is a species of magnificent tranquility, not easy to express. Legitimate usurpation would seem to me to be the most appropriate expression, if not to bold, to characterize these kinds of origins, which time hastens to consecrate. Chapter 3. Polar Symbolism, the Lord of Peace and Justice. It is possible to connect the integral and original understanding of the regal function with a further cycle of symbols and myths that point back in the same one direction through their various representations and analogical transpositions. As a starting point, we may consider the Hindu notion of the Chakravartin, or Universal King. The Chakravartin may be considered the archetype of the regal function, of which various kings represent more or less complete images or even particular expressions whenever they conform to the traditional principle. Chakravartin literally means lord or spinner of the wheel. This notion brings us back again to the idea of a center that corresponds also to an inner state, to a way of being, or better yet, to the way of being. Actually, the wheel also symbolizes samsara, or the stream of becoming. The Hellenes called it Kalklos Tias Genesios, the wheel of generation, or Kalklos Onyx, the wheel of fate. Its motionless center signifies the spiritual stability inherent in those who are not affected by the stream and who can organize and subject to a higher principle the energies and the activities connected to the inferior nature. Then the Chakravartin appears as the Dharmara, the lord of the law, or the lord of the wheel of the law. According to Confucius, the practice of government by means of virtue may be compared to the pole star, which the multitudinous stars pay homage to while it stays in its place. Hence the meaning of the concept of revolution, which is the motion occurring around an unmoved mover, though in our modern day and age it has become synonymous with subversion. In this sense, royalty assumes the value of a pole by referring to a general traditional symbolism. We may recall here, besides Midgard, the heavenly middle abode described in Nordic traditions. Blade is referenced to the place where Zeus holds counsel with the gods in order to reach a decision concerning the fate of Atlantis. He accordingly summoned all the gods to his own most glorious abode, which stands at the center of the universe and looks out over the whole realm of change. The above-mentioned notion of Chakravartin is also connected to a cycle of enigmatic traditions concerning the real existence of the center of the world that exercises the supreme function here on Earth. Some fundamental symbols of regality had originally a close relationship with these ideas. One of these symbols was the scepter, the main function of which is analogically related to the axis of the world. Another symbol is the throne, an elevated place. Sitting still on the throne evokes, in addition to the meaning of stability connected to the pole and to the unmoved mover, the corresponding inner and metaphysical meanings, considering the correspondence that was originally believed to exist between the nature of the royal man and the nature produced by initiation. In the classical mysteries, we find a ritual consisting of sitting still on a throne. This ritual appears to have been very important since it was sometimes equated with initiation itself. The term Tethersuos, enthroned, is often synonymous with Thalatuos, initiate. In fact, in some instances, in the course of an initiation of Threnesuos, or royal enthronement, preceded the experience of becoming one with the god. The same symbolism is embodied in the ziggurat, the Assyrian-Babylonian terraced pyramid, as well as in the master plan of the capital of the Persian kings, as in Ekbatana, and in the ideal image of the Chakravartin's royal palace. In these places, we find the architectural expression of the cosmic order complete in its hierarchy and in its dependence upon an unmoved center. From a spatial perspective, this center corresponded, within the building itself, to the king's throne. Similar to Helios, in India we find forms of initiation that employ the ritual of the so-called mandala. These forms dramatize the gradual ascent of the initiate from the profane and demonic space to a sacred space, until he reaches a center. A fundamental ritual symbolizing this journey is called Miki Torbasaka, and it consists in being crowned or in being given a tiara. He who reaches the center of the mandala is crowned as king because he is now believed to be above the interplay of the forces at work in the inferior nature. It is interesting that the ziggurat, the sacred building towering above the city-state of which it was the center, was called cornerstone in Babylon and link between heaven and earth in Lhasa. The theme of the rock and of the bridge is pretty much summed up in the Far Eastern expression, third power between heaven and earth. The importance of these traces and correlations should not be overlooked. Moreover, stability has the same double dimension. It is at the center of the Indo-Aryan formula for consecration of the kings. Remain steady and unwavering. Do not give in. Be strong like a mountain. Stay still like the sky and the earth and retain control of power at all times. The sky, the earth, and the mountains are unmoved as the world of living beings and this king of men. In the formulas of the Egyptian royalty, stability appears as an essential attribute that complements the attribute of power life already present in the sovereign. And just as the attribute of vital force, the correspondence of which with the secret fire has already been emphasized, stability has a heavenly counterpart. Its hieroglyphic, Jed, conveys the stability of the solar gods resting on pillars or on light beams. These examples bring us back to the system of Initia. Since they are much more than abstract ideas, like power and vital force. Stability too, according to the Egyptian tradition, is simultaneously an inner state of being and an energy, a vortex that flows from one king to the next, and which sustains them in a supernatural way. Moreover, the Olympian attribute and the attribute of Heis are connected to the condition of stability in the esoteric sense of the word. Kings, who derive their power from the supreme god and who have received victory at his hands, are lighthouses of peace in the storm. After glory, centrality, polarity, and stability, Heis is one of the fundamental attributes of regality that has been preserved until relatively recent times. Dante talked about the Emperor Pacificus, a title previously bestowed on Charlemagne. Obviously, this is not the profane and social peace pursued by a political government. A kind of peace that is at most an external consequence, but rather an inner and positive peace, which should not be divorced from the triumphal element. This peace does not convey the notion of cessation, but rather that of the highest degree of perfection of a pure, inner and withdrawn activity. It is a calm that reveals the supernatural. According to Confucius, a man destined to be a ruler, the virtues, unlike ordinary men, rests in rectitude and is stable and unperturbed. The men of affairs enjoy life, but the virtues prolongs it. Hence that great calm that conveys the feeling of an irresistible superiority and terrifies and disarms the adversary without a fight. This greatness immediately evokes the feeling of a transcendent force that is already mastered and ready to spring forward, or the marvelous and yet frightful sense of the noumen. The Pax Romana Aetia Augusta, which is connected to the transcendent sense of the impi, may be considered one of the several expressions of these meanings in the context of a universal historical realization. Conversely, the ethos of superiority over the world, of dominating calm and of imperturbability combined with readiness for absolute command, which has remained the characteristic of various aristocratic types even after the secularization of nobility, must be considered an echo of that element that was originally the regal, spiritual, and transcendent element. The Chakravartin, besides being the Lord of Peace, is Lord of the Law, or Cosmic Order, Tra, and Lord of Justice, Dharmaro. Peace and justice are two more fundamental attributes of royalty that have been preserved in Western civilization until the time of the Hohenzollerns and Dante, even though the political aspect predominated over the higher meaning presupposing it. Moreover, these attributes were also found in the mysterious figure of Melchizedek, King of Salem, one of the many representations of the function of the universal king. Genin has pointed out that in Hebrew, Melchizedek means king of justice, while Salem, of which he is king, is not a city, but rather peace, at least according to Paul Zagid. Tradition upholds the superiority of Melchizedek's royal priesthood over Abraham's. It is not without a deep reason that Melchizedek was present in the enigmatic medieval allegory of the Three Rings, and that he declared that neither Christianity nor Islam know any longer which is the true religion. Moreover, the royal religion of Melchizedek was often upheld by the Ghibelline ideology in the struggle against the church. At this level, the expression King of Justice is the equivalent of the previously mentioned Dharmara, designating the universal king. From this expression, we may gather that in this context, justice and peace do not have a secular meaning. In fact, Dharma in Sanskrit also means proper nature of or the law typical of a certain being. The correct reference concerns the particular primordial legislation that hierarchically orders, in a system oriented upwards, every function and form of life according to the nature of every being, Saitama, or according to justice and truth. Such a notion of justice is also characteristic of the Platonic view of the state. This view, rather than an abstract, utopian model, should be regarded in many aspects as an echo of traditional orientations from an even more distant past. In Plato, the idea of justice, of which the state should be the embodiment, is closely related to that of Heisoumene, that is, with the principle according to which everybody should fulfill a function typical of his or her own nature. Thus, the king of justice is also the primordial legislator, or he who instituted the caste, assigned the offices, and established the rights, or, in other words, he who determined the ethical and sacred system that was called Dharmagan in India. And that in other traditions was the local ritual system that determines the norms for regulating individual and collective life. This presupposes that the royal condition enjoys a higher power of knowledge. The capability to deeply and perfectly understand the primordial laws of human beings is the basis of authority and of command in the Fardi. The Mysian royal glory, each Vorak Ana, is also the virtue of a supernatural intellect. And while according to Plato the philosophers should be at the top of the hierarchy of the true state, for him the above-mentioned traditional idea takes on an even more specific form. For Plato, wisdom or philosophy is understood as the knowledge of that which is, rather than the knowledge of illusory visible forms. The philosopher is one who can effectively formulate laws conforming to justice precisely because he has the direct knowledge of that which is supremely real and normative. The conclusion Plato draws is, until philosophers are kings, or the kings and princes of this world have the spirit and power of philosophers, and political greatness and wisdom meet in one, and these calmer natures who pursue either to the exclusion of the other are compelled to stand aside, cities will never have rest from their evils, nor the human race itself. Chapter 4. The Law, the State, the Empire. The traditional society's view of both the law and the state is closely related to the order of ideas that I have been discussing so far. Generally speaking, a transcendent realism is the presupposition of the traditional notion of the law. Especially in Aryan formulations, the notion of law has an intimate relationship with the notions of truth, reality, and stability inherent to that which is, in the Vedas, the term to often has the same meaning as dharma. It not only signifies the order found in the world as order or kosuus, but it has a deeper meaning whenever it designates truth, law, or reality, just as its opposite, andra, designates falsehood, evil, or unreality. Thus, the world of the law and consequently of the state came to be equated with the world of truth and of reality in the eminent sense of the word. As a natural consequence, traditional man either ignored or considered absurd the idea that one could talk about laws and the obedience due them if the laws in question had a mere human origin, whether individual or collective. Every law, in order to be regarded as an objective law, had to have a divine character. Once the divine character of a law was sanctioned in its origin traced back to a non-human tradition, then its authority became absolute. This law became then something ineffable, inflexible, immutable and beyond criticism. Thus, every transgression of such law was regarded not so much as a crime against society, but rather and foremost as sacrilege or as an act of impious ebia, or as an act that jeopardized the spiritual destiny of the person who disobeyed it as well as of the people with whom that person was socially related. This is why, up to and including medieval civilization, rebellion against authority and the imperial law was considered as serious a crime as religious heresy. Thus the rebels were considered just like heretics, namely, as the enemies of their own natures and as beings who contradict the law of their very own being. Herein India employed a special expression to designate those who broke the caste law. They were called the fallen ones, or the laps, more on which later. The usefulness of the law in the modern sense of the word, that is, its collective and empirical usefulness, was never the true criterion adopted in ancient times, not that this aspect was never considered, but it was rather thought to be an accessory or consequential aspect in every law. Once a law was sanctioned as true, after all, there are different views of what constitutes usefulness. The notion of usefulness is the ultimate materialistic criterion of modern society, though that was not the case in traditional societies, which rather regarded it as a means to be employed in the function of a higher purpose. But for a law to be considered useful, it was necessary to appear as something other than a mere and repealable creation of the human will. Once it was established that its authority originated from above, its usefulness and efficacy were definitively acknowledged. This certainty was never questioned, even in those cases in which experience, in the most immediate and unrefined meaning of the word, did not confirm and even proved such a law to be wrong somehow, since as the saying goes, the web of heaven's way is complex and incomprehensible. This is why in the traditional world the creation of a system of laws and rituals was always attributed to divine legislators or to divine mediators. These beings, in turn, were considered as various forms or apparitions of the Lord of the Center, or King of Justice, the forms being determined by different geographical areas and by different populations. And even when in more recent times the electoral system was introduced, tradition retained a partial formal existence when the people's decision was not considered to be sufficient. In that case, in order for new laws to be finally ratified, it was necessary to obtain the approval of the pontifexes and to make sure that the diviners ascertained whether these laws enjoyed the gods' approval. Moreover, laws and institutions, as in the case of all traditional civilizations, were both from above and oriented upwards. A political, economic, and social order created merely for the sake of temporal life is exclusively characteristic of the modern world, that is, of the anti-traditional world. Traditionally, the state had a transcendent meaning and purpose that were not inferior to the ones the Catholic Church claimed for itself and the West as a manifestation of, and a path to, the world above. The very term state in Latin status, from the Greek istemi, to stay, empirically may have derived from the form of social life taken up by nomadic populations once they permanently settled down. However, it may also point to a higher meaning, namely, to an order concerned with hierarchical participation in a spiritual stability as opposed to the contingent, unstable, changeable, chaotic, and particularistic character of a naturalistic existence. This order constituted the accurate reflection of the world of being in the world of becoming, hence the words pronounced in the course of a Vedic royal consecration. This world of the living is steady, and so is this king of the people. In this way, traditional states and empires often employed the symbols of centrality and of polarity that have been associated with the archetype of regality. Thus, while the ancient Chinese Empire was called the Middle Empire, and the seat of the world according to Nordic legends was called Midgard, the middle abode or center of the world, the capital of the Inca Solar Empire was called Cusco, or navel of the world. Likewise, in ancient Greece, Delphi enjoyed the same designation as the center of Doric civilization. It would be easy to find analogous references in different civilizations, all pointing to the ancient meaning of traditional states and organizations. Generally speaking, in prehistoric times the symbolism of sacred stones already points to the same order of ideas, the alleged fetishism of the cult of the stones partially being a mere fancy of modern researchers. The omphala, or sacred stone, is not a naive representation of the shape of the world. Its meaning in Greek, navel, brings it back to the idea of a center, of a stable point. And it can also be related to what may be called sacred geography. The sacred stone is often found, and not without reason, in selected ritual places that served as traditional centers in relation to a given historical cycle or to a given people. The meaning of the sacred stone was often that of a foundation from above, especially when the stone was from the sky, namely, an aerolith. Some examples are the lapis niger of the ancient Roman tradition and the stone of destiny, the black fiddle stone figuring in the British and Celtic traditions, which was important for its alleged ability to recognize legitimate kings among various pretenders to the throne. Following the same order of ideas, in Wolfram von Eschenbach's view, the Grail was a mysterious, divine stone that also had the power of revealing who was worthy of the royal dignity. Hence, the obvious meaning of the trial consisting in being able to draw a sword from a stone, Theseus and Helice, Sohrab in Persia, King Arthur in ancient Britannia, and so on. The doctrine of the two natures, which is the foundation of the traditional view of life, is also reflected in the relationship that exists between the state and the people, demos. The idea that the state derives its origin from the demos, and that the principle of its legitimacy and its foundation rest upon it is an ideological perversion typical of the modern world and essentially represents a regression. With this view, we regress to what was typical of naturalistic social forms lacking an authentic spiritual chrism. Once this direction was taken, an inevitable downward spiraling occurred, which ended with the triumph of the collectivistic world of the masses and with the advent of radical democracy. This regression proceeds from a logical necessity and from the physical law of gravity that affects falling bodies. According to the traditional view, on the contrary, the state was related to the people, just as the Olympian and Rhenian principles are related to the thonic and infernal world, or as idea, form, or nose, are related to matter, nature, aureole, or as the luminous masculine, differentiating, individualizing, and life-giving principle is related to the unsteady, promiscuous, and nocturnal feminine principle. Between these two poles there is a deep tension, which in the traditional world was resolved in the sense of a transfigure and of the establishment of an order from above. Thus, the very notion of natural rights is a mere fiction, and the anti-traditional and subversive use of that is well documented. There is no such thing as a nature that is good in itself and in which the inalienable rights of an individual, which are to be equally enjoyed by every human being, are performed and rooted. Even when the ethnic substance appears to be somewhat well-defined, in other words, when it presents some elementary forms of order, these forms, unless they are residues and traces of previous formative actions, do not have a spiritual value in and of themselves unless by participating in a higher order, such as when they are assumed in the state or an analogous traditional organization, they are first consecrated as being from above. In the end, the demosa substance is always demonic in the ancient non-Christian and a moral sense of the word. It always requires a catharsis or a liberation before it can act as a force, namus, and as the material of a traditional political system, and before it can favor the development of a differentiated and hierarchical order of dignity over and beyond a naturalistic substratum. In this regard, we shall see that the main principle upon which the differentiation between people and the hierarchy of the traditional castes is built has not been political or economical, but spiritual, and thus was developed an authentic system of participations as well as the progressive stages of a conquest and a victory of the Khams over chaos. In addition to the four major castes, the Indo-Aryan tradition knew a broader and more significant distinction that points to the duality of natures. I am referring to the distinction between the Arya or Vyeo and the Shudra. The former were the nobles or the twice-born, who represented the divine element Teve. The latter were beings who belonged to nature, and thus who represent the promiscuous substratum of the hierarchy that was gradually overcome by the formative influence exercised within the higher caste, from the heads of the households to the Brahmana. Strictly speaking, this influence was the original meaning of the state and of the law within the world of tradition. It had a meaning of supernatural formation, even where it did not manifest itself immediately in visible ways, because of either incomplete applications of the principle or later materialistic and degenerative processes. These premises are the foundation upon which the potential affinity between the principle of every state and that of universality is founded. Wherever an action takes place that is aimed at constituting life beyond the limits of nature and of contingent and empirical existence, it is unavoidable that some forms not connected to the particular will manifest themselves. The dimension of that which is universal may appear in different aspects and different degrees in various civilizations and traditional organizations. The formative process always encounters resistance from matter, which in its determinations caused by time and space acts in a differentiating and particularistic sense in relation to the effective historical application of the one principle that in itself is superior and antecedent to these manifestations. Nevertheless, there is no form of traditional organization which, despite any local characteristics, any empirical exclusivism, any autofinicism of the cults and institutions it jealously defends, that does not hide a higher principle. This principle is actualized whenever the traditional organization reaches the heights of the idea of the empire. Thus, there are cult ties of sympathy and of analogy between the individual traditional formations and something unique, indivisible, and perennial, and these ties are portrayed in many ways. Once in a while, it is possible to detect in certain historical institutions, such as monarchies and empires, an esoteric and universal core that transcends the specific geographical and historical dimensions of said institutions, thus culminating in a unity of a higher kind. Such are the imperial peaks of the world of tradition. Ideally, one same line runs from the traditional idea of law and the state to that of empire. We have seen that the opposition between the higher caste, which are characterized by rebirth, and the inferior caste of the Shudra was considered by the Indo-Aryans as an opposition between the divine and the demonic element. In Iran, the higher caste were believed to correspond to emanations of the heavenly fire descended to earth, and more specifically upon three distinct peaks. After the glory, Atrino, the supreme form that was embodied in kings and priests, such supernatural fire descended hierarchically to castes or classes of the warriors and of the patriarchal wealthy leaders, Rithisa and Vistria Shyant, until it reached and glorified the lands occupied by Aryan descent. In the ancient Persian tradition, this was the background against which a metaphysical view of the empire was formulated in the terms of a reality unrelated to space and time. There are two possibilities. On the one hand, there is the Ashayah, the pure, the faithful on earth and the blessed in heaven. The Ashayah is one who boosts the power of the principle of light here on earth and the domain proper to him. The Ashayah is exemplified by the members of three classes, the lords of the ritual and of fire, who exercise an invisible power over occult influences, the warriors, whose job is to fight against barbarians and impious people, and finally, those who work on the dry and arid land, whose job is a militia, since fertility is almost a victory that increases the mystical vertus of the Aryan land. On the other hand, opposed to the Ashayin are the Einashayin, the impure ones, those without law, or those who oppose the principle of light. In this context, the empire as a traditional system governed by the King of Kings corresponds to what the principle of light has successfully snatched from the snares of the principle of darkness. The limit of the empire is illustrated by the myth of the Hirashayin, the universal lord of future, complete, and victorious kingdom of peace. A similar idea is found in the legend according to which the Emperor Alexander the Great contained the onslaught of the peoples of Gog and Magog by building an iron wall. These people may represent in this context the demonic element that in the traditional hierarchies was successfully subjugated. One day these people will flood the earth in pursuit of conquest, but they will ultimately be challenged by figures who, according to medieval sagas, will embody the archetype of the leaders of the Holy Roman Empire. A similar idea is expressed in some Nordic traditions with the image of the bulwarks that protect the middle abode, the legendary Midgard, from the elementary powers and that one day will be overpowered during the twilight of the gods, the Ragnaraka. The relation between Aeternatis and Impi is also found in the Roman tradition, hence the transcendent, non-human character with which the notion of Regere is associated. This is why the pagan world credited the gods for the greatness of Rome, the city of the eagle and of the axe. According to another view endowed with a deeper meaning, the world will not end as long as the Roman Empire existed. This idea is connected to the function of mystical salvation attributed to the empire, provided that the world is not understood in physical or political terms, but rather in terms of cosmos and end of a dam of order and stability containing the disruptive forces of chaos. In relation to this theme, the Byzantine continuation of the Roman ideal acquires a particular meaning owing to the markedly theological and eschatological nature animating that ideal. The empire, which even in this context is conceived as an image of the heavenly kingdom, is willed and preordained by God. In the empire, the earthly sovereign, the basileus autocrator, is himself an image of the Lord of the universe. As the Lord himself, the sovereign is alone and without a second. He presides over both the temporal and the spiritual domains, and his formal right is universal. This right extends even over people who have an autonomous government and who are not directly subjected to the real imperial power. Any such government being considered barbaric and not, according to justice, since it has a mere naturalistic foundation. The subjects of the empire are the Romans, Romae, no longer in an ethical and juridical sense, but in the sense of a superior dignity and chrism, since they live in the pax guaranteed by a law that is a reflection of the divine law. The imperial ecumene sums up the order of salvation as well as that of the law in the higher sense of the word. The ideal of the empire emerged one more time in the Ghibelline Middle Ages with the same metahistorical content, that is, as a supernatural universal institution created by providence as a remedium contra infirmitem peccat in order to straighten the fallen human nature and direct people to eternal salvation. This ideal was for all practical purposes paralyzed both by the church and by historical circumstances, which precluded its comprehension as well as its effective realization according to its higher meaning. Dante, for instance, from a traditional point of view was correct in claiming for the empire the same origins and supernatural destiny of the church. He was also correct in talking about the emperor as one who, owning everything and no longer wishing for anything else, is free of concupiscence, and who can therefore allow peace and justice to reign and thus strengthen the active life of his subjects. After the original sin, this life can no longer resist the seductions of cupidigis unless a higher power controls it and directs it. Although he expressed traditionally correct views about the empire, Dante Alighieri was unable to carry these ideas beyond the political and material plane. In Dante's view, the emperor's perfect possession is not an inner possession, typical of those who are, but it is rather a territorial possession. Also, the cupidigis that he abhors is not the root of an unregenerated life tied to the law of becoming and lived out in a naturalistic state, but rather the cupidigis of the princes competing for power and riches. Again, according to him, peace is that of the world, which constitutes the anticipation of a different order beyond that of the empire and of a contemplative life in an ascetical Christian sense. Tradition lives on, however, although only in faint echoes. With the Hohenschaffen dynasty, tradition had a last bright flicker. Eventually empires would be replaced by imperialisms and the state would be understood only as a temporal, national, particularistic, social, and plebeian organization. Chapter 5. The Mystery of the Right. As the king by divine right was the center of the traditional state, two elements, right and faithfulness, fides, connected particular components and activities within the social order to this center and allowed individuals to partake of the transcendent influence emanating from the sovereign. The right was the original cement binding together traditional organizations, whether large or small, considered in their non-naturalistic dimension. The right was first of all the prerogative of the king, second, of the aristocratic or priestly classes and of the magistrates, whom the Greeks called oenidiol, those whose responsibility is to perform sacrifices, and finally, of the piedpress, or heads of households. Rites and sacrifices were regulated by detailed and strict traditional norms that left no room for anything arbitrary or subjective. The performance of rites and sacrifices was imperative, strictum. A ritual or sacrifice that was neglected or performed by an unqualified person, or performed in a way that did not conform to traditional rules, was considered a cause of misfortune for both individuals and society, since it unleashed dreadful powers both in the moral and in the material order. Conversely, in the classical world, it was said that the priest in charge of the holy fire saved the city through his ritual, day after day, and the Chinese tradition to establish the rites was the first of the three most important things in the government of an empire. Since the rites were the channels by which we can apprehend the ways of heaven, in the Hindu tradition, the sacrificial sites were considered to be the seats of the Kansak order, Tra, itself. It is very significant that the expression tra, atha, in Persian, appears in connection with analogous conceptions as the root of the Latin word ritus, ritual action, in the ancient traditional way of life. Both at an individual and at a collective level, every action was connected with a determined ritual element that acted as its support and as the transfiguring and guiding element from above. The tradition of rites and sacrifices, which was often confused with the legislative tradition, hence the notion of osed, referred both in the private and in the public dimensions to a non-human being or to a being who had transcended the human condition. This can hardly be comprehended by the modern, secular mentality that views every ritual either as an outdated superstition or as a mere ceremony to be appreciated merely for the sake of its symbolica, aesthetical, or emotional value. At this point, I wish to discuss some of the aspects and meanings of this particular form of the traditional spirit. As far as a sacrifice is concerned, according to a text universally regarded as very old, Brahman, which in the beginning constituted the entire universe, created a higher and more perfect form of itself from which the gods of the warriors Indra, Mitra, and so on, came into existence. The primordial power's ability to go beyond itself, an act that is credited with the origination of entities that are the heavenly archetypes of the divine and triumphal regality, is strictly connected with the nature of an entire class of sacrifices. The similar idea is found in a cycle of other myths in which we witness a fundamental identity between heroes and gods who fight victoriously against the personifications of the forces of caste. This is the same notion of a primordial power that reacts against itself, frees itself, and ascends to a higher plane of being that defines its peculiar divine aspect, the Upanishad's highest and most perfect form of itself. This plane of being often manifests itself in a law or in a principle of order. For example, the Chaldean hero Marduk, who overcame Tiamat, the demon of Kes, is a cosmic principle of order. In Hindu cosmogony, the vital force produces the one of creation through asceticism, tapas taipati. In the Nordic tradition, the same idea is expressed through Odin's sacrifice to the cosmic tree Yggdrasil, through which Odin draws out of the abyss the transcendent wisdom contained in the runes and puts it to good use. Also, in one specific version of this myth, Odin, who is viewed as a king, through his sacrifice points the way that leads to Valhalla, namely, to the type of action that allows a person to partake of the heroic, aristocratic, and reigning immortality. According to its original meaning, the type of sacrifice to which I refer corresponds to either a similar action that generates a god or hero, or to its repetition, which is connected to a sacrificial tradition centered on that particular god or hero. This repetition either renews the effective power of that god or reproduces it and develops it within the order of a given community. In the Egyptian tradition, these meanings find a very important expression. According to a myth, Osiris is believed to be the one who taught mankind how to perform rites as well as the sacred art of temple construction. Osiris is also the god of rites since he himself, first among all the gods, went through sacrifice and experienced death. His death and dismemberment by Set are related to his being the first to penetrate the unknown of the other world and to his becoming a being who knows the great secret. The myth is developed in the saga of Horus, son of Osiris, who resurrects his father. Horus finds the proper rites, Kiwa, that give back to Osiris, who has gone into the other world or, strictly speaking, into the supernatural, the form that he previously had. Through death and rites, Osiris, the first among all beings, knew the mystery in a new life. The science in this life were the privilege of beings who were considered divine. It is from this perspective that Osiris was thought to have initiated both men and gods into sacred rituals. He had shown to beings who inhabit the heavens and earth how to become a god. From then on, the cult belonging to all divine beings or deified beings consisted in reenacting the mystery of Osiris. This was true first of all for the king. The sacrificial mystery of Osiris was repeated not only in the ritual of the enthroning and in the solemn rite called said repeated every 30 years, but also in the daily cult, which aimed at renewing in the pharaoh the transcendent influence associated with his function. The king publicly acknowledged his kingship and paid homage to Osiris by piecing him back together and by renewing his death and victory. The king was called Horus, who shapes the father, Osiris, and also the giver of life, or he who through the rite makes divine life arise in a regal fashion, like the sun. The sovereign became Horus, who resuscitated Osiris, or was the resurrected Osiris himself. Similarly, in the mysteries, the initiates often took their name from the god who had founded those same mysteries, since the initiation reproduces the same act that constitutes the essence of the god, thus determining an analogical similarity of natures. Sometimes this similarity is figuratively described as incarnation or generation. What has been said also applied to the rite in general, that is, to the rite dedicated to the hero or to the founding father to whom the traditional patrician family lines often attributed their non-material origins as well as the principle of the ranking of their rites. It also applied to the rite dedicated to the cult of the founders of an institution, of a legislation, or of a city who were believed to be non-human beings. In these instances, too, it is believed that in the origins an action analogous to a sacrifice took place that produced a supernatural quality that remained as a potential spiritual legacy within the stock as the soul of those institutions, laws, or foundations. In these cases, rites and various ceremonies helped to actualize and to nourish that original influence, which by virtue of its own nature appeared to be a principle of well-being, good fortune, and happiness. Having clarified the meaning of a relevant body of traditional rites allows me to establish an important point. There are two elements within the traditions of those civilizations or of those castes characterized by Iranian chrism. The first element is a materialistic and a naturalistic one. It consists of the transmission of something related to blood and race, namely, a vital force that originates in the subterranean world together with the elementary, collective, and ancestral influences. The second element is from above, and it is conditioned by the transmission and by the uninterrupted performance of rites that contain the secret of a certain transformation and domination. There lies within the above-mentioned vital substratum. The latter element is the higher legacy that confirms and develops the quality the divine forefather has either established ex novo or attracted from another world. This quality originates the royal stock, the state, the city or the temple, and the caste, the gens or the patrician family according to the supernatural dimension that acts as a form-shaping chaos. Both of these elements were found in the higher types of traditional civilizations. This is why the rites could appear to be manifestations of the heavenly law, according to a Chinese saying. The unfolding of the ritual action par excellence in its most complete form, e.g., the Vedic sacrifice, reveals three distinct phases. First of all, there was a ritual and spiritual purification on the part of the person performing the sacrifice that put him in real contact with invisible forces and facilitated the possibility of his dominating them. What followed was an evocative process that produced a saturation of these energies either within the person performing the sacrifice, within the victim. With the exception of those cases in which the rite is aimed at creating a new entity destined to be this soul or the genius of a new tradition, a new city, or a new temple, traditionally even the construction of cities and temples had a supernatural counterpart. What took place was something similar to the releasing and the resealing of hidden forces. In other words, what took place was the evocative renewal of the contact with the infernal forces that acted as the substratum of a primordial deification, as well as with the violence that freed and elevated them to a higher form. This explains the danger believed to be associated with the repetition of a traditional rite and also the reason why the person performing the sacrifice was called viral hero. A rite that fails or that goes wrong or that deviates in any way from its original form wounds and defeats God, it is sacrilegum. Once a law has been altered, the seal of a supernatural dominion is broken and dark, ambiguous, and dreadful forces are unleashed. Even neglecting a rite has a similar effect. It lessens the presence of the god in the relationship with those who are guilty of such neglect, and it strengthens those energies that were tamed and restrained in the god himself. In other words, it opens the doors to chaos. Conversely, a correctly performed and diligent sacrificial action was reputed to be the support that men and gods provide for each other in their mutual interest. The fate awaiting those who no longer have any right is the infernal regions. They fall from the supernatural order they had potism into the states of the lower nature. It has been said that only the sacrificial action does not create a bond. Olympe Odorous wrote that the whole world is one great symbol, since it reflects invisible realities through sensible forms. Plutarch wrote, among the things that belong to a higher order there are secret connections and correspondences, just like in the order of natural phenomena. These connections cannot be recognized other than through experience, traditions, and universal consensus. A characteristic expression of Jewish esotericism is, through the impulse from below there is a stirring above, and through the impulse from above there is a stirring higher up still. Thus by the impulse of the smoke of sacrifice from below the lamp is kindled above, and when this is kindled all the other lamps are kindled and all the worlds are blessed from it. By the impulse of the sacrifice is the mainstay of the world and the blessing of all worlds. This may be considered the general profession of faith of traditional civilizations. According to modern man, both causes and effects are relegated to the physical plane, framed within time and space. According to traditional man, the physical plane merely contains effects. Nothing takes place in this world that did not originate first in the next world or in the invisible dimension. In this sense, too, it is possible to see how the rite takes hold and affects the development of all actions, destinies, and ways of traditional life. In traditional societies, the action par excellence consisted in shaping events, relations, victories, and defense mechanisms through the rite, that is, in preparing causes in the invisible dimension. Any material action not connected to this supreme action was impaired by a radical contingency. The very soul of an individual is inadequately protected from the dark and elusive forces acting within human passions, thoughts, and inclinations and behind the scenes of nature and of history. All things considered, it is difficult to label as fanciful the fact that traditionally the performance of the rite was considered one of the fundamental principles in the hierarchical differentiation of people, and generally speaking, it was closely associated with every authority within the state, the gens, and the family itself. It is possible to reject the traditional world en bloc, but it is not possible to deny the intimate logical connection of all its parts, once its foundation has been properly understood. Chapter 6. On the Primordial Nature of the Patriciate. The Indo-Aryan civilization exemplifies one of the most thorough applications of the foregoing principles. In this civilization, the Brahmana caste was not at the top of the social hierarchy by virtue of its material strength or its wealth, or even of its para-ecclesiastical organization. Only the sacrificial rite, which was its privilege, determined its higher status vis-a-vis other castes. By permeating those who performed them with some kind of dreadful and beneficial psychic power, the rite and the sacrifice allowed the Brahmana to partake of the same nature as the evoked powers. Not only would this quality abide in that person forever, making him directly superior to and revered and feared by others, but it would also be transmitted to his descendants, having entered into the bloodstream as some sort of transcendent legacy. This quality would become the characteristic feature of a race that is activated in individuals by the rite of initiation. The dignity of a caste was determined both by the difficulty and by the usefulness of the functions it exercised. Because of the above-mentioned presuppositions, in the world of tradition nothing was cherished more than the spiritual influences that the rite could activate through its necessitating action. Nothing appeared as difficult as entering into a real and active relation with the invisible forces that were ready to overcome the imprudent person who dared to confront them without possessing the necessary qualifications and knowledge. For this reason, the Brahmana caste, despite the fact that it was scattered throughout India, could evince the respect of the masses and enjoy a prestige that no tyrant ever enjoyed, no matter how well armed. In China, as well as in Greece and ancient Rome, the patriciate was essentially characterized by the possession and by the practice of those rites that were connected to the divine power emanating from the founder of a family. In China, only the patricians practiced the rites, yili, while the plebeians merely had customs. There is a Chinese saying, the rites are not the legacy of ordinary people, which corresponds to the famous saying of Hippos Claudius, auspiciam patrum. A Latin expression characterized the plebeians as gentem non habent, people who have no rights nor ancestors. This is why in ancient Rome, the patricians viewed the plebeians' lifestyle and sexual coupling as similar to that of wild animals, more ferum. Thus, the supernatural element was the foundation of the idea of a traditional patriciate and of legitimate royalty. What constituted an ancient aristocrat was not merely a biological legacy or a racial selection, but rather a sacred tradition. In fact, even an animal may have biological and racial purity. After all, in the caste system, the laws of blood, heredity, and endogamic restrictions did not apply only to the Brahmana but to the other caste as well. It was not in this sense that the plebeian was said to lack ancestors. The true principle of the differentiation between patricians and plebeians was that the ancestors of the plebeian and of the slave were not divine ancestors, ivi parentes, like the ancestors of the patrician stocks. No transcendent quality or form entrusted to a rigorous and secret ritual tradition was transmitted to them through the blood. The plebeians lacked that power through which the members of the aristocracy could directly celebrate their own cults or be members of the priestly class, as was the case in the ancient classical world, in ancient northern and Germanic races, in the Far East, and so on. The plebeians did not have the privilege of the second birth that characterized the heir, the noble, and the Minutha does not hesitate to say that even an heir is not superior to the suitor until he has been born again. The plebeians were not purified by any of the three heavenly fires that in ancient Iran were believed to act as the occult souls of the three higher castes in the empire. The plebeians also lacked the solar element that in ancient Peru characterized the race of the Incas. The plebeians' promiscuity had no limits. They had no true cult of their own, and in a higher sense they had no founding father, patrum care non possent. Therefore the plebeians' religion could not help but have a collective and thonic character. In India, their religion was characterized by frenzied and ecstatic forms more or less connected to the substratum of pre-Aryan races. In the Mediterranean civilizations, the plebeians' religion was characterized by the cult of the mothers and by subterranean forces instead of the luminous forms of the heroic and Olympian tradition. The plebeians, who in ancient Rome were called children of the earth, had a religious devotion to the feminine deities of the earth. Even in China, the official aristocratic religion stood in contrast with the practices of those who were often called obsessed, Ling Pao, and with the popular cults of a Mongolian and shamanic type. We find the supernatural conception of the aristocracy also in ancient Teutonic traditions. Not only because in these traditions every leader was at the same time the high priest of his people and of his lands, but also because claiming as an ancestor a divine being was enough to separate a family from all the others. A king was then chosen exclusively from among the members of these privileged families. This is why the king enjoyed a different dignity from that enjoyed, for instance, by a military leader, Dux or Itzago, who was occasionally appointed in military situations on the basis of his recognized individual talents. It seems that ancient Norwegian kings celebrated the rites by themselves, without the help of the priestly class. Even among the so-called primitive populations, those who had not been initiated were looked down upon by their own people and excluded from all the military and political privileges of their clan. Before undergoing rites that were destined to transform one's innermost nature and that were often associated with hard trials and with a period of isolation, a person was not considered to be a true man but was rather seen as belonging to the same class as women, children, and animals. An individual became a member of the group of true men who control the community only through the new life awakened in him by initiation, almost as if he partook of a mystery or joined an order. Once an individual partakes of this new life, which is almost unrelated to the old one, he receives a new name, a new language, and new attributions. Thus, authors such as H. Schertz have rightfully seen in this the germ of true political unity. This insight corroborates what I have said before concerning the plane proper to any traditional state, which is different from the plane typical of any unity built on merely naturalistic premises. These viral groups in German, Meerbund, to which one is admitted after a regeneration that truly confers manhood and differentiates a person from all other members of the community, enjoy power and an undisputed prestige. Only in recent times has aristocracy, like royalty, taken on a mere secular and political character. In the beginning, aristocracy and royalty were based on character, race, honor, valor, and faithfulness, on noblesse epi and on noblesse decor. In later times, a plebeian view of the aristocracy arose that denied even the privileges of blood and tradition. A typical example of the latter view is the so-called aristocracy of culture, or the aristocracy of intellectuals that arose as a byproduct of bourgeois civilization. During a census taken in the reign of Frederick the Great, The head of an ancient German noble family humorously replied, "An alphabet wegen des Hohenadels," in reference to the ancient notion of the British lords who were considered experienced in the law and learned, even though they may not know how to read. The truth is that in the context of a normal hierarchical view, the principle that determined the precise ontological and essential differences between people and was at the basis of the notion of aristocracy and of its privileges was never intellectuality, but rather spirituality. The tradition was preserved, though in an attenuated form, up to the time of the knightly nobility, where it was embodied in a somewhat ascetical and sacred aspect in the great medieval orders. At that point, the nobility already had its main reference point in the sacred, not in but outside itself and in a separate class, namely, the clergy, although the clergy represented a spirituality that was still a far cry from the spirituality of the primordial elites. The ritual and sacra element was the foundation of the authority of both the higher caste and of the father and the ancient patrician family. In Western Aryan societies such as Greece and Rome, the pater familii originally enjoyed a status similar to that of the priest-king. The term pater was synonymous with king, hence the words rex, ax, basilist. It conveyed the idea of a spiritual authority as well as that of power and majestic dignity. According to some views with which I totally concur, the state is an application on a larger scale of the same principle that in the beginning constituted the patrician family. Therefore the pater, though he was the military leader and the lord of justice of his relatives and slaves, in primis etiamme was the person entrusted with performing those traditional rites and sacrifices proper to every family, the rites and sacrifices that constituted its non-human legacy. This legacy, which emanated from the founding father, was represented by fire. For example, the 30 fires of the 30 families surrounding the central fire Vesta in ancient Rome. This fire, which was fed with special substances and lit according to specific rituals and secret norms, was supposed to be kept burning at all times by every family as the living and tangible witness of its divine legacy. The father was the virile priest in charge of tending to the sacred family fire, but he was also one who must have appeared like a hero to his children, relatives, and servants, or like the natural mediator of every efficacious relationship with the supernatural, or like the supreme vivifier of the mystical force of the ritual, which was present in the substance of fire, or like the incarnation of order, as Angan was to the Indo-Aryans, or like the principle that brings the gods to us, or like the firstborn from order, or like the son of strength, or like he who leads us away from this world, to higher dimensions, into the world of the right action. The pater's main responsibility was to prevent the fire from going out so that it might continue to reproduce, perpetuate, and nurture the mystical victory of the ancestor. This responsibility to the fire was the manifestation of the regal component of his family, with the pater being the lord of the spear and of the sacrifice. In this way, the pater really constituted the center of the family. The entire rigorous constitution of traditional paternal rites flowed from this center as a natural consequence, and it subsisted even when the awareness of its primordial foundation was lost. In ancient Rome, anyone who, like the pater, had the os quiridum, the right to bear the lance and to perform sacrifices, also had the right to own land. His privileges could never be abrogated. He spoke on behalf of the gods and on account of power. Just like the gods, he expressed himself through symbols and signs. He was immaterial. Originally, it was not possible, nulla auctoritas, to prosecute a patrician legally, since he was regarded as a minister of the gods, just like the king in recent times. If the patrician committed a crime in his mundus, the curia would only declare that he did something wicked, improbe factum. His rights over his relatives were absolute, as vita nequisque. His superhuman character made it natural for him to sell and even to put to death his own children, at his own discretion. It was in this spirit that the articulations of what Wicca rightly called natural heroic rights or divine rights of heroic people were formulated. According to a patrician tradition, the right, which corresponded to a Iranian component, enjoyed primacy over other elements of the same tradition that were related to nature. This can be established from several aspects of the ancient Greco-Roman laws. It has rightfully been said that in antiquity, what united the members of a family was something more powerful than birth, healings, and physical strength. It was the cult of the hearth and of the ancestors. This cult shaped the family into a united body, both in this world and in the next. The ancient family was more religious than a natural association. The common ritual constituted the true bond of the family's unity and often even of the gens itself. If an outsider was allowed to participate in the common right, he thereby became an adoptive son who enjoyed those privileges that could also be taken away from a biological son guilty of neglecting the right of his family, or from a son who was interdicted from participating in it. This obviously meant that according to the traditional idea, right rather than blood had the power to unite or to differentiate people. In India, Greece, and Rome, a woman had to mystically join her future husband's family or gens through the rite. The bride, before being a man's bride, was the bride of Ainga or the mystical fire. Those who were allowed to participate in the cult proper of a patrician stock were thereby allowed to enjoy an ennobling mystical participation that conferred upon them some of the privileges of that particular stock, while at the same time they committed their future offspring to it. Consequently, it is possible to understand the sacred aspect of the feudal principle as it previously emerged in ancient Egypt, since through the mystical gift of life emanating from him, the king gathered around himself a body of faithful subjects who were elevated to the priestly dignity. Analogous ideas can be found in Peru among the Incas, the children of the sun, and to a certain extent, even among the Japanese feudal nobility. In India, one finds the idea, which should be reduced to the doctrine of the sacrifices in general, of a family line of male descendants, primogeniture, that is strictly related to the problem of immortality. The firstborn, who alone has the right to invoke Indra, the heavenly warrior god, is seen as the one whose birth frees the father of his debt to the ancestors. Thus, it is said that the firstborn frees or saves Trey, the ancestors in the world beyond. The firstborn, standing on the battlefield represented by this earthly existence, confirms and continues the line of influence that constitutes the ancestor's substance and that is carried on in the bloodstream as a purifying fire. It is significant that the firstborn is believed to have been generated in order to fulfill a duty to this ritual commitment that is not affected by human feelings or ties. It is not impossible, therefore, that in some cases a family derived by adaptation from a superior and purely spiritual type of unity found in older times. For instance, Lhasa hinted that the family arose at the end of a relationship of direct participation, through blood, with the original spiritual principle. A similar idea still echoes as a residue in the priority acknowledged by several traditions of spiritual paternity over natural paternity, or of a second birth versus natural birth. In ancient Rome, for instance, we could refer to the inner aspect of the dignity conferred at the time of adoption, which was understood as an immaterial and supernatural filiation that was believed to take place under the aegis of Olympian deities. At one point in time, adoption was also chosen as the basis for the continuation of the imperial function, according to an ancient Hindu text, that his mother and father produced him through mutual desire and he was born in the womb, he should regard as his mere coming into existence. But the birth that a teacher produces for him is real, free from old age and free from death. In this way, natural relationships not only are secondary, but they may also be reversed. Thus, according to the same text, the Brahmana who brings about the Vedic birth of an older person and who teaches him his own duties becomes his father, according to law, even if he is himself a child. Or if the law of Hypotessas was considered from a social and juridical point of view to be absolute and almost superhuman, such a law could enjoy the spiritual character only if it had, or if it originally had, such a justification in the order of spiritual paternity, and also if it was related to blood ties as thus, so it was related to the body within the organic unity of the family stock. I will not dwell further on these concepts. However, it is noteworthy that a body of ancient beliefs also postulates the idea of a unity that is not merely biological but psychospiritual as well. Thus, the guilt of a family member was believed to affect the entire family. Also, according to this idea, a family member may redeem another or carry out an act of vengeance on behalf of another, and so on. In all of these aspects, one finds repeated confirmation of the view according to which traditional institutions were ordered from above and were not based on nature but on sacred legacies and on spiritual actions that bind, free, and shape nature, and the divine dimension what counts as the blood in the family. The state, the community, the family, bourgeois feelings, duties in the modern, profane, human, and social sense of the word, all these are human fabrications, things entirely made up and existing outside the realm of traditional reality, in the world of shadows. The light of tradition did not know any of these things. Chapter 7. Spiritual Virility. So far, I have discussed the roles that the sacred, the gods, the priestly class, and the rites played in traditional societies. In the world of tradition, these things hardly correspond to categories typical of the domain of religion in the current sense of the word, based as it is on the notion of deities conceived as self-sufficient beings and the notion of God as a personal being who providentially rules the universe. Moreover, the cult is essentially characterized by an affective disposition and by a sentimental and devotional relationship of the believer to this supreme being or deities. In this type of relationship, the moral law plays a fundamental role. One would look in vain for religion in the original forms of the world of tradition. There are civilizations that never named their gods or attempted to portray them. At least this is what is said about the ancient Polystean. The Romans themselves, for almost a century, did not portray their deities. At most, they represented them with a symbolic object. What characterizes the primordial times is not animism, the idea that an anima is the foundation of the general representation of the divine and of the various forces at work in the universe, but rather the idea or perception of pure powers, adequately represented by the Roman view of the noumen. The noumen, unlike the notion of deus, as it later came to be understood, is not a being or a person, but a sheer power that is capable of producing effects, of acting, and of manifesting itself. The sense of the real presence of such powers, or noumena, as something simultaneously transcendent and yet immanent, marvelous yet fearful, constituted the substance of the original experience of the sacred. A well-known saying of Servius emphasizes that in the origins, religion consisted in nothing else but experience. Even though more conditioned points of view were not excluded from esotericism, those traditional forms reserved for the common people, inner doctrines were characterized by the teaching that the personal forms of deities, variously abd, are only symbols of superrational and superhuman ways of being. As I have said, the center consisted in the real and living presence of these states within an elite, or in the ideal of their realization through what in Tibet is called the direct path, and which generally corresponds to initiation conceived as an ontological change of nature. The saying from the Upanishads that best represents the traditional inner doctrine is, "So whoever worships another divinity than his self, thinking, he is one and I another, he knows not. He is like a sacrificial animal for the gods." With regard to the rite, there was nothing religious about it and little or no devout pathos in those who performed it. The rite was rather a divine technique, a determining action upon invisible forces and inner states similar in spirit to what today is obtained through physical forces and states of matter. The priest was simply a person who, by virtue of his qualification and the virtus intrinsic to the rite itself, was capable of producing results through this technique. Religion was the equivalent of the indigicamenta of the ancient Roman world, namely, of the body of formulations used with different noumena. Thus it is easy to see that prayers, fears, hopes, and other feelings displayed before what has the character of noumen had as little meaning and effect upon it as if one of our contemporaries were to employ prayers when confronting a machine. Instead, what was at stake was to be able to understand such a relationship so that once a cause was established through a correctly performed rite, a necessary and constant effect would ensue on the plane of powers and invisible forces and states of being. Thus, the law of action reigns supreme. But the law of action is also the law of freedom. No bond can be spiritually imposed on beings who neither hope nor fear, but rather act. Thus, in the older Noarian view of the world, only the Brahmana caste, consisting as it did of superior natures, could tower over everybody else since it ruled over the power of the right, or of Brahman, understood in this context as the vital and primordial principle. Gods themselves, when they are not personifications of the ritual action, that is, beings who are actualized or renewed by this action, are spiritual forces that bow before this caste. According to the Far Eastern tradition, the person who is authority also enjoys the dignity of a third power between heaven and earth. In ancient Egypt, even the great gods could be threatened with destruction by priests who knew special sacred content. Kemoghuf, his mother's bull, was a title of the Egyptian king, emphasizing that as a man, the king possesses the primordial substance. He affects the divine more than being affected by it. One of the formulations recited by the Egyptian kings before the performance of the rites was, "O gods, you are safe if I am safe, your doubles are safe if my double is at the head of all living doubles, everybody lives if I live." Formulations of glory, power, and total identification are recited by the soul, rendered like Osiris in the course of its trials. These trials, in turn, can be assimilated to various degrees of soul or initiation. Similar traditions are perpetuated wherever an Alexandrian literature mention is made of the holy race of people without kings, a race autonomous and immaterial that acts without being acted upon. This race is believed to be endowed with a sacred science centuries old that is proper to the lords of the spirit and of the temple, and communicated only to kings, princes, and priests. This science is related to the rituals of the pharaohs, and later on it came to be known in the Western world as Ars Regae. In the higher forms of the luminous Aryan spirituality, whether in Greece, ancient Rome, or the Far East, the role played by doctrine was minimal. Only the rituals were mandatory and absolutely necessary. Orthodoxy was defined through rituals and practices and not through dogmas and theories. Sacrilege and impiety did not consist in not believing but rather in neglecting rites. This does not amount to formalism, as modern historians, who were more or less influenced by a Protestant mentality, would have believed, but rather to the pure law of spiritual action. In the Dorkachian ritual, the relationship with the divine was not based on feelings but on an attitude characterized by duet des. Even the gods presiding over funerals were not treated very religiously. They did not love men, nor were they loved by them in return. The reason behind their cult was to propitiate them and to prevent them from exercising an unfavorable action. The expiatio itself originally had the character of an objective operation, such as the medical procedure for an infection, without resembling either a punishment or an act of repentance on the part of a soul. The formulations employed by every patrician family and by every ancient city in their relationship with the forces controlling their destinies had been previously employed by their divine forefathers to overcome spiritual forces, noumena. Thus, these formulations were merely the legacy of a mystical domain. They were not the effusion of feelings but a supernaturally efficacious weapon, provided that not a single technique was changed in the course of the rite. Wherever the traditional principle was applied in its entirety, it is possible to find, in its hierarchical differentiations, a transcendent virility that finds its best symbolic expression in the synthesis of the two attributes of the Roman patrician class, namely, the lance and the right. There one also finds beings who are regicychrome, inly free, and often consecrated by Olympian immortality. With regard to invisible and divine forces, these beings exercise the same function of centrality and the same role that leaders exercise among human beings. A very long downward path or degenerated process unwinds from this peak to what is currently and commonly considered religion and priesthood. The world of animism represents a fall from and an attenuation of the world perceived under the species of powers and of noumena. This attenuation and degeneration was destined to increase with the shift from a world in which souls were inherent in things and in the elements to a world in which the gods were conceived as persons in an objective sense rather than as figurative allusions to non-human states, forces, and possibilities. When the efficacy of the rite disappeared, man was motivated to give a mythological individuality to those forces with which he had previously dealt according to simple relationships of technique or which, at most, he had conceived under the species of symbols. Later on, man conceived these forces in his own image, thus limiting human possibilities. He saw in them personal beings who were more powerful than he was, and who were to be addressed with humility, faith, hope, and fear, not only to receive protection and success, but also liberation and solace, in its double meaning of health and salvation. The hyperrealistic world that was substantiated with pure and sheer action was replaced with the subreal and confused world of emotions, imagination, hopes, and fears. This world became increasingly human and powerless as it followed various stages of the general involution and alteration of the primordial tradition. Only vis a vis this decadence is it possible to distinguish the regal and the priestly functions. Even when a priestly class ruled without departing from the pure traditional spirit, as in the case of ancient India, it had a much more magical and regal rather than religious character, in the usual sense of the word religious. When I say magical, I do not mean what today the majority of people think when they hear the term magic, which is almost always discredited by prejudices and counterfeits. Nor do I refer to the meaning the term acquires when referred to the sui generis empirical science typical of antiquity, which was rather limited in its scope and effects. Magic in this context designates a special attitude towards spiritual reality itself, an attitude of centrality that is closely related to regal tradition and initiation. Secondly, it does not make sense to emphasize the relation between the magical attitude, the pure ritual, the impersonal, direct, and numinous perception of the divine and the way of life of savage tribes, which according to the Judeo-Christian mentality are still unaware of true religiosity. In most cases, savage tribes should not be considered as pre-civilized states of mankind, but rather as extremely degenerated forms of remnants of very ancient races and civilizations. Even though the above-mentioned particulars are found among savage tribes and are expressed in materialistic, dark, and shamanic forms, this should not prevent us from recognizing the meaning and the importance they assume once they are brought back to their true origins. Likewise, magic should not be understood on the basis of those wretched and degenerated remnants, but rather on the basis of the forms in which it was preserved in an active, luminous, and conscious way. These forms coincide with what I have called the spiritual virility of the world of tradition. It does not come as a surprise that most noted modern historians of religion have no idea whatsoever about this concept. The confusions and the prejudices found in their highly documented works are most unfortunate. Chapter 8, The Tepaz and the Afterlife. At this point, it is necessary to discuss the connection between the order of ideas I have outlined so far and the problem of one's destiny in the afterlife. In this context, too, reference should be made to teachings that have almost entirely been lost in recent times. The belief that everybody's soul is immortal is rather odd. Very little evidence of it can be found in the world of tradition. In tradition, a distinction was made between true mortality, which corresponded to participation in the Olympian nature of a god, and mere survival. Also, various forms of possible survival came into play in the problem of the postmortem condition of each individual is analyzed, always taking into consideration the various elements present in the human aggregate, since man was far from being reduced to the simple binomial soul body. What continuously emerges in various forms in ancient traditions is the teaching that in man, in addition to the physical body, there are essentially three entities or principles, each endowed with its own character and destiny. The first principle corresponds to the conscious, atypical of a waking state, which arose with the body and was formed in parallel with its biological development. This is the ordinary personality. The second principle was called demon, mains, lur, and even double. The third and last principle corresponds to what proceeds from the first entity after death. For most people, it is the shadow. As long as a person belongs to nature, the ultimate foundation of a human being is the demon or tzimin, daemon in Greek. In this context, the term does not have the evil connotation Christianity bestowed upon it. When man is considered from a naturalistic point of view, the demon could be defined as the deep force that originally produced consciousness in the finite form that is the body in which it lives during its residence in the visible world. This force eventually remains behind the individual in the preconscious and in the subconscious dimensions as the foundation of organic processes and subtle relations with the environment, other beings, and with past and future destiny. These relations usually elude any direct perception. In this regard, in many traditions, the demon corresponds to the so-called double, which is perhaps a reference to the soul of the soul or the body itself. This double has also often been closely associated with the primordial ancestor or with the totem conceived as the soul in the unitary life that generated a stock, a family, a gens, or a tribe, and therefore it has a broader sense than the one given to it by some schools of contemporary ethnology. The single individuals of a group appear as various incarnations or emanations of this demon or totem, which is the spirit pulsating in their blood. They live in it and it lives in them, though transcending them, just as the matrix transcends the particular forms it produces out of its own substance. In the Hindu tradition, the demon corresponds to that principle of man's inner being called lingasara. The word linga contains the idea of a generating power, hence the possible derivation of genius from genera, which means to act in the sense of begetting. And hence, the Roman and Greek belief that the genius or lar, demon, is the same procreating force without which a family would become extinct. It is also very significant that totems have often been associated with the souls of selected animal species, and that especially the snake, essentially a telluric animal, has been associated in the classical world with the idea of demon or of genius. These two instances bear witness to the fact that in its immediacy this force is essentially subpersonal, and belongs to nature and to the infernal world. Thus, according to the symbolism of the Roman tradition, the seat of the Les is underground. They are in the custody of a female principal, Mania, who is the Mater Lerum. According to esoteric teachings, at the death of the body, an ordinary person usually loses his or her personality, which was an illusory thing even while that person was alive. The person is then reduced to a shadow that is itself destined to be dissolved after a more or less lengthy period culminating in what was called the second death. The essential vital principles of the deceased return to the totem, which is a primordial, perennial, and inexhaustible matter. Life will again proceed from this matter and assume other individual forms, all of which are subject to the same destiny. This is the reason why totems, manes, lead, or panades, the gods of the Roman people, to whom we owe the breath within us and by whom we possess our bodies and our power of thought too, were identified with the dead. The cult of the ancestors, the demons, and the invisible generating force that is present in every body was often confused with the cult of the dead. The souls of the deceased continue to exist in the demons into whom they were dissolved, but also in those forces of the stock, the race, or the family in which the life of these demons was manifested and perpetuated. This teaching concerns the naturalistic order. There is, however, a second teaching relating to a higher order and a different, more privileged, aristocratic, and sacred solution to the problem of survival after death. It is possible to establish a connection here with the ideas expressed above concerning those ancestors who, through their victory, bestowed a sacred legacy upon the ensuing patrician generations that reenact and renew the rite. The heroes or demigods to whom the higher caste and the noble families of traditional antiquity traced their lineage were beings who at death, unlike most people or unlike those who had been defeated in the trials of the afterlife, did not emanate a shadow or the lore of an ego that was eventually destined to die anyway. Instead, they were beings who had achieved the self-assistant, transcendent, and incorruptible life of a god. They were those who had overcome the second death. This was possible because they had more or less directly imposed upon their own vital force that change of nature I mentioned before when talking about the transcendent meaning of sacrifice. Ancient Egyptian traditions clearly articulated the task of creating out of the ka, another name for the double or the demon, some kind of new incorruptible body, sayu, that was supposed to replace the physical body and stand on its own feet in the invisible dimension. In other traditions, it is possible to find the identical concept under the names of immortal body, body of glory, or resurrection body. Therefore, if in their traditions the Greeks of Homer's time, as in the first Aryan period when the Vedas were written, did not contemplate the survival of the soul alone, but instead believed the survivors, those who had been kidnapped or made invisible by the gods and who had settled in the island of the blessed, where there is no death, retained soul and body in an indissoluble unity. This should not be understood as a coarse materialistic representation, as many historians of religion today are inclined to believe, but as the symbolic expression of the idea of an immortal body and the condition for immortality. This idea enjoyed its classical formulation in Far Eastern esotericism, and more specifically, in operative Taoism. The Egyptian sahu, created by the rite, thanks to which the deceased can go on to live in the company of solar gods, indicates the body that has achieved a high degree of knowledge, power, and glory and that has thus become everlasting and incorruptible. This body is referred to in the following formulation: your soul lives, your body germinates eternally at Ra's command without any diminution or defect, just like Ra's. In this context, the attainment of immortality or the victory over adverse powers of dissolution is related to wholeness, namely, to the inseparability of the soul from the body, better yet, from a body that does not undergo decay. There is a very suggestive Vedic formula, leaving behind every fault, go back home. Filled with splendor, be reunited with your body. The Christian dogma of the resurrection of the flesh that will take place on Judgment Day is the last echo of this idea, which can be traced back to prehistoric times. In these instances, death did not represent an end but a fulfillment. It was a triumphal death bestowing immortality and was the reason why in some Hellenic traditions the deceased was called hero and dying was called generating demigods, or why the deceased was portrayed wearing a crown, often put on his head by the goddesses of victory, made with the same myrtle that identified those who were going to be initiated into the Eleusinian mysteries, or why in the Catholic liturgical language the day of death is called Dies Natalis, day of birth, or why in Egypt the tombs of the deceased who had been dedicated to Osiris were called Houses of Immortality, and the afterlife was conceived as the Land of Triumph, or why in ancient Rome the emperor's demon was worshipped as divine, and why the kings, legislators, victorious generals, and founders of those institutions or traditions that were believed to involve an action and a conquest beyond nature were worshipped as heroes, demigods, gods, and avatars of different deities. The sacred foundation of the authority the elders enjoyed in several ancient civilizations lies in similar ideas. People saw in the eye, who were closer to death, the manifestation of the divine force that was thought to achieve its full liberation at death. Thus, as far as the destiny of the soul after death is concerned, there are two opposite paths. The first is the path of the gods, also known as the Solar Path or Zeus Path, which leads to the bright dwelling of the immortals. This dwelling was variously represented as a height, heaven, or an island, from the Nordic Valhalla and Asgard to the Aztec Inca House of the Sun that was reserved for kings, heroes, and nobles. The other path is that trodden by those who do not survive in a real way, and who slowly yet inexorably dissolve back into their original stocks, into the totems that, unlike single individuals, never die. This is the life of Hades, of the Infernals, of Nilfheim, of the Thonic deities. This teaching is found in the Hindu tradition where the expressions Devayani and Padayani signify Path of the Gods and Path of the Ancestors, in the sense of manes, respectively. It is also said, these two paths, one bright and the other dark, are considered eternal in the universe. In the former, man goes out and then comes back. In the latter, he keeps on returning. The first path, leading to Brahman, namely, to the unconditioned state, is analogically associated with fire, light, the day, and the 6 months of the solar ascent during the year. It leads to the region of Thunderbo, located beyond the Lindor of the sun. The second path, which is related to smoke, night, and the 6 months of the sun's descent, leads to the moon, which is the symbol of the principle of change and becoming, and which is manifested here as the principle regulating the cycle of finite beings who continuously come and go in many ephemeral incarnations of the ancestral forces. According to an interesting symbolism, those who follow the lunar path become the food of the manes and are sacrificed again by them in the semen of new mortal births. According to another significant symbol found in the Greek tradition, those who have not been initiated, that is to say, the majority of people, are condemned in Hades to do the Danaan's work, carrying water and amphorae filled with holes and pouring it into bottomless barrels, thus never being able to fill them up. This illustrates the insignificance of their ephemeral lives, which keep recurring over and over again. Pa. Another comparable Greek symbol is Octis, who plaited a rope on the plains of Leth. This rope was continually eaten by an ass. Akas symbolizes man's activity. While the ass traditionally embodies the demonic power, in Egypt the ass was associated with the snake of darkness and with Mmit, the Devi of the dead. In this context, we again find the basic ideas concerning the two natures that I discussed in the first chapter. But here it is possible to penetrate deeper into the meaning of the existence and antiquity not only of two types of divinities, the former Iranian and solar, the latter telluric and lunar, but also of the existence of two essentially distinct types, at times even opposed to each other, of rite and cult. A civilization's degree of faithfulness to tradition is determined by the degree of the predominance of cults and rituals of the first type over those of the second type. Likewise, the nature and the function of the rites proper to the world of spiritual virility is specified. A characteristic of what today goes by the name of the science of religions is that whenever by sheer chance it finds the right key to solve a mystery, it reaches the conclusion that this key is good to solve all mysteries. Thus, when some scholars learned about the idea of the totem, they began to see totems everywhere. The totemic interpretation was shamelessly applied to the forms found in great civilizations, since some scholars thought that the best explanation for them could be derived from earlier studies on primitive tribes. Last but not least, a sexual theory of the totem eventually came to be formulated. I will not say that the shift from the totems of those primitive populations to a traditional regality was a historical development. At most, it was an evolution in an ideal sense. A regal or aristocratic tradition arises wherever there is dominion over the totems, not dominion of the totems. And wherever the bond is inverted and the deep forces of the stock are given a superbiological orientation by a supernatural principle in the direction of an Olympian, victory and immortality. To establish ambiguous promiscuities that make individuals more vulnerable to the powers on which they depend as natural beings. Allowing the center of their being to fall deeper and deeper into the collective and into the pre-personal dimensions and to placate or to propitiate certain infernal influences, granting them their wish to become incarnate in the souls and in the world of men. This is the essence of an inferior cult that is only an extension of the way of being of those who have no cult and no right at all. In other words, it is the characteristic of the extreme degeneration of higher traditional forms to free human beings from the dominion of the totems, to strengthen them, to address them to the fulfillment of a spiritual form and a limit, and to bring them in an invisible way to the line of influences capable of creating a destiny of heroic and liberating immortality. This was the task of the aristocratic cult. When human beings persevered in this cult, the fate of Hades was averted and the way of the mother was barred. Once the divine rites were neglected, however, this destiny was reconfirmed and the power of the inferior nature became omnipotent again. In this way, the meaning of the above-mentioned Oriental teaching is made manifest, namely, that those who neglect the rites cannot escape hell, this word meaning both a way of being in this life and a destiny in the next. In its deepest sense, the duty to preserve, nourish, and develop the mystical fire, which was considered to be the body of the god of the families, cities, and empires, as well as, according to a Vedic expression, the custodian of immortality, without any interruption concealed the ritual promise to preserve, nourish, and develop the principle of a higher destiny in contact with the overworld that were created by the ancestor. In this way, this fire is most intimately related to the fire, which especially in the Hindu and in the Greek view and, more generally speaking, in the Olympian Aryan ritual of cremation, burns in the funeral pyre. This fire was the symbol of the power that consumes the last remains of the earthly nature of the deceased until it generates beyond it the fulgurating form of an immortal. Chapter 9. Life and Death of Civilizations. In those areas in which tradition retained all of its vitality, the dynastic succession of sacred kings represented an axis of light and of eternity within the temporal framework, the victorious presence of the supernatural in the world, and the Olympian component that transfigures the demonic element of chaos and bestows a higher meaning to state, nation, and race. Even in the lower strata of a society, the hierarchical bond created by a conscious and virile devotion was considered a means to approach, and to participate in, the supernatural. In fact, invested with authority from above, the simple law acted as a reference and a support that went beyond mere human individuality for those who could not light the supernatural fire for themselves. In reality, the intimate, free, and effective dedication of one's entire life to traditional norms, even when a full understanding of their inner dimension was not present to justify such an adherence, was enough to acquire objectively a higher meaning. Through obedience, faithfulness, and action in conformity with traditional principles and limitations, an invisible force shaped such a life and oriented it toward that supernatural axis that in others, in those privileged few at the top of the hierarchy, existed as a state of truth, realization, and light. In this manner, a stable and lively organism was formed that was constantly oriented toward the overworld and sanctified in power and in act according to its hierarchical degrees in the various domains of thinking, healing, acting, and struggling. Such was the climate of the world of tradition. All of the exterior life was a rite, namely, an approximation, more or less efficacious and depending on individuals and groups, to a truth that the exterior life cannot produce by itself, but that allows a person to realize oneself in part or entirely, provided it is lived in a saintly way. These people lived the same life that they led for centuries. They made of this world a ladder in order to achieve liberation. These peoples used to think, to act, to love, to hate, and to wage war on each other in a saintly way. They had erected the one temple among a great number of other temples through which the stream of the waters ran. This temple was the bed of the river, the traditional truth, the holy syllable in the heart of the world. At this level, to leave the parameters of tradition meant to leave the true life. To abandon the rites, alter or violate the laws or mix the caste corresponded to a regression from a structured universe, cosmos, back into chaos, or to relapse to the state of being under the power of the elements and of the totems, to take the path leading to the hells where death is the ultimate reality and where a destiny of contingency and of dissolution is the supreme rule. This applied to both single individuals and to entire peoples. Any analysis of history will reveal that just like man, civilizations too, after a dawn and an ensuing development, eventually declined and died. Some people have attempted to discover the law responsible for the decline of various civilizations. I do not think that the cause or causes can be reduced to merely historical and naturalistic factors. Among various writers, Degobine is the one who probably better demonstrates the insufficiency of the majority of the empirical causes that have been adduced to explain the decline of great civilizations. He showed, for instance, that a civilization does not collapse simply because its political power has been either broken or swept away. The same type of civilization sometimes endures even under a foreign occupation and defies the worst catastrophic events, while some other times, in the presence of mediocre mishaps, it just disappears. Not even the quality of the governments in the empirical, namely, administrative and organizational, sense of the word, exercises much influence on the longevity of civilizations. Degobine remarks that civilizations, just like living organisms, may survive for a long time even though they carry within themselves disorganizing tendencies in addition to the spiritual unity that it is the life of the one common tradition. Indian feudal Europe, for example, showed precisely the absence of both a unitary organization and a single economic system or form of legislation on the one hand and a marked pluralism with repeatedly recurring antagonisms on the other. Not even the so-called corruption of morals, in its most profane and moralistically bourgeois sense, may be considered the cause of the collapse of civilizations. The corruption of morals at most may be in effect, but it is not the real cause. In almost every instance we have to agree with Nietzsche, who claimed that wherever the preoccupation with morals arises is an indication that a process of decadence is already at work. The Moss of Wicca's Faroe Ages has nothing to do with moralistic limitations. The Far Eastern tradition especially has emphasized the idea that morals and laws in general, in a conformist and social sense, arise where virtue and the way are no longer known. When the Tao was lost, its attributes appeared. When its attributes were lost, benevolence appeared. When benevolence was lost, righteousness appeared. And when righteousness was lost, the propriety appeared. Now propriety is the attenuated form of filial piety and good faith, and is also the commencement of disorder. As far as the traditional laws are concerned, taken in their sacred character and in their transcendent finality, then just as they had a non-human value, likewise they could not be reduced in any way to the domain of morality in the current sense of the word. Antagonism between peoples or a state of war between them is in itself not the cause of a civilization's collapse. On the contrary, the imminent sense of danger, just like victory, can consolidate, even in a material way, the network of a unitary structure and heat up a people's spirit through external manifestations, while peace and well-being may lead to a state of reduced tension that favors the action of the deeper causes of a possible disintegration. The idea that is sometimes upheld against the insufficiency of these explanations is that of race. The unity and the purity of blood are believed by some to be the foundation of life and the strength of a civilization. Therefore, the mixing and the ensuing poisoning of the blood are considered the initial cause of a civilization's decline. This too is an illusion, which among other things, lowers the notion of civilization to a naturalistic and biological plane, since this is a plane on which race is thought of in our day and age. Race, blood, hereditary purity of blood. These are merely material factors. A civilization in the true, traditional sense of the word arises only when a supernatural and non-human force of a higher order, a force that corresponds to the pontifical function, to the component of the right, and to the principle of spirituality as the basis of a hierarchical differentiation of people, acts upon these factors. At the origin of every true civilization there lies a divine event. Every great civilization has its own myth concerning divine founders. Thus, no human or naturalistic factor can fully account for it. The adulteration and decline of civilizations is caused by an event of the same order, though it acts in the opposite, degenerative sense. When a race has lost contact with the only thing that has and can provide stability, namely, with the world of being, and when in a race that which forms its most subtle yet most essential element has been lost, namely, the inner race and the race of the spirit, compared to which the race of the body and of the soul are only external manifestations and means of expression, then the collective organisms that a race has generated, no matter how great and powerful, are destined to descend into the world of contingency. They are at the mercy of what is irrational, becoming, and historical, and of what is shape from below and from the outside. Blood and ethnic purity are factors that are valued in traditional civilizations too. Their value, however, never justifies the employment, in the case of human beings, of the same criteria employed to ascertain the presence of pure blood in a dog or in a horse, as is the case in some modern racist ideologies. The blood or racial factor plays a certain role not because it exists in the psyche, in the brain, and in the opinions of an individual, but in the deepest forces of life that various traditions experience and act upon as typical formative energies. The blood registers the effects of this action, yet it provides through heredity a material that is performed and refined so that through several generations, realizations similar to the original ones may be prepared and developed in a natural and spontaneous way. It is on this foundation, and on this foundation only, that, as we shall see, the traditional world often practiced the heredity of the caste and willed endogamous laws. If we refer, however, to the Indo-Aryan tradition in which the caste system was the most rigorously applied, simply to be born in a caste, though not considered enough, it was necessary for the quality virtually conferred upon a person at birth to be actualized by initiation. I have already mentioned that according to the Manu Dharmasastra, unless a man undergoes initiation or second birth, Even though he may be an Aryan, he is not superior to a shooter. I also related how three special differentiations of the Divine Fire animated the three hierarchically higher Persian Pisher, and that definite membership in one of them was sealed at the moment of initiation. Even in these instances, we should not lose sight of two factors being present, and never mistake the formative element for the element that is formed, nor the conditioning for the conditioned factor. Both the higher castes and traditional aristocracies, as well as superior civilizations and races, those that enjoy the same status that the consecrated castes enjoy vis-a-vis the plebeian castes of the children of the earth, cannot be explained by blood, but through the blood, by something that goes beyond blood and that has a metabiological character. When this something is truly powerful, or when it constitutes the deeper and most stable nucleus of a traditional civilization, then that civilization can preserve and reaffirm itself, even when ethical mixtures and alterations occur. No matter how destructive they may be, by reacting on the heterogeneous elements and shaping them, by reducing them slowly but gradually to their own type, or by regenerating itself into a new, vibrant unity. In historical times, there are a number of cases of this: China, Greece, Rome, Islam. Only when a civilization's generating root from above is no longer alive and its spiritual race is worn out or broken does its decline set in, and this in tandem with its secularization and humanization. When it comes to this point, the only forces that can be relied upon are those of the blood, which still carries atavistically within itself, through race and instinct, the echo and the trace of the departed higher element that has been lost. It is only in this way that the racist thesis in defense of the purity of blood can be validly upheld, if not to prevent, at least to delay the fatal outcome of the process of dissolution. It is impossible, however, to really prevent this outcome without an inner awakening. Analogous observations can be made concerning the value and the power of traditional forms, principles, and laws. In a traditional social order, there must be somebody in whom the principle upon which various institutions, legislations, and ethical and ritual regulations are based is truly active. This principle, though, must be an objective spiritual realization and not a simulacrum. In other words, what is required is an individual or an elite to assume the pontifical function of lords and mediators of power from above. Then even those who can only obey but who cannot adopt the law other than by complying with the external authority and tradition are able intuitively to know why they must obey. Their obedience is not sterile because it allows them to participate effectively in the power and in the light. Just as when a magnetic current is present in a main circuit and induced currents are produced in other distinct circuits, provided they are syntonically arranged likewise, some of the greatness, stability, and fortune that are found in the hierarchical apex pass invisibly into those who follow the mere form and the ritual of the pure heart. In that case, the tradition is firmly rooted, the social organism is unified and connected in all of its parts by an occult bond that is generally stronger than external contingencies. When at the center, however, there is only a shallow function or when the titles of the representatives of the spiritual and regal authority are only nominal, then the pinnacle dissolves and the support crumbles. A highly significant legend in this regard is that of the people of Gog and Magog, who symbolize chaotic and demonic forces that are held back by traditional structures. According to this legend, these people attack when they realize that there is no longer anybody blowing the trumpets on that wall upon which an imperial type had previously arrested their siege, and that it was only the wine that produced the sounds they were hearing. Rites, institutions, laws, and customs may still continue to exist for a certain time, but with their meaning lost and their virtue paralyzed, they are nothing but empty shells. Once they are abandoned to themselves and have become secularized, they crumble like parched ole and become increasingly disfigured and altered, despite all attempts to retain from the outside, whether through violence or imposition, the lost inner unity. As long as a shadow of the action of the superior element remains, however, and an echo of it exists in the blood, the structure remains standing, the body still appears endowed with a soul, and the courts, to use an image employed by De Gobino, walks and is still capable of knocking down obstacles in its path. When the last residue of the force from above and of the race of the spirit is exhausted, in the new generations nothing else remains. There is no longer a river bid to channel the current that is now dispersed in every direction. What emerges at this point is individualism, chaos, anarchy, a human's hubris, and degeneration in every domain. The dam is broken. Although a semblance of ancient grandeur still remains, the smallest impact is enough to make an empire of state collapse and be replaced with a demonic inversion, namely, with the modern, omnipotent Leviathan, which is a mechanized and totalitarian collective system. From prehistoric times to our own day and age, this is what evolution has been all about. As we shall see, from the distant myth of divine regality through the descent from one caste to the next, mankind will reach the faceless forms of our contemporary civilization in which the tyranny of the pure demos and the world of the masses is increasingly and frightfully reawakening in the structures of mechanization. Chapter 10. Initiation and Consecration. Having defined the essence of both the pinnacle and center of a traditional civilization, it is necessary to describe briefly some of its external features that refer to already conditioned existential situations. This will enable me to indicate the origin of the first alteration of the world of tradition. The regal idea occurs in an already weakened form when it no longer becomes incarnate in beings who are naturally above human limitations, but rather in beings who must develop this quality within themselves. In the ancient Hellenic tradition, such a distinction corresponded analogically to that between a god, Olympian ideal, and a hero. In terms of the Roman tradition, this distinction was formally sanctioned through the titles of Deus and Divus, the latter always designating a man who had become a god, the former designating a being who had always been a god. According to tradition, in Egypt the regal race of the Thi was replaced by that of the Amithi, who correspond to the heroes, who in turn precede in time the race of the Nikus, an expression subject to being referred mainly to human leaders. What emerges in this context is a situation in which there is a certain distance between the person and the function being exercised. In order for a person to embody a certain function, what is required is a specific action capable of producing in him a new quality. This action may appear either in the form of an initiation or of an investiture, or consecration. In the first case, this action has a relatively autonomous and direct character. In the second case, it is mediated, or it takes place from the outside through a priestly caste distinct from the regal caste. As far as the regal initiation is concerned, it will suffice to repeat what has been said about the ritual, sacrificial, and triumphal actions that reenact those deeds attributed to a god or a hero with the intent of actualizing, evoking, or renewing the corresponding supernatural influences. This occurred in a very specific way in ancient Egypt. As I have said, the king at his enthronement reenacted the sacrifice that made Osiris a transcendent divinity. This rite was used not only as a way to renew the quality of a nature that was already divine by birth, but also and foremost as an initiation aimed at arousing the dimension of transcendence in the man who was destined to be king and at granting him the gift of life. As far as the details of similar rites are concerned, I will limit myself to describing the rite that in the Eleusinian Mysteries corresponded to the bestowal of the regal title. The future king first spends some time in solitary confinement, then he must move across a river through blood and vortices. In other words, he crosses the stream of generation by means of his own strength, leaving behind on the riverbank his old body, soul, and personality. The river is later crossed again by boat, and the king wears animal skins. These skins apparently signify totemic powers that emerged as a consequence of the suspension of the ephemeral, external eye, powers that also represented the powers of the community. This symbolism was meant to establish a contact and an identification with the supernatural dimension. In the Bacchic ritual, after devouring the victims, the Kurbantes wore their skins. This was meant as an identification with the god represented by the sacrificial victims and as the act of taking on his strength and nature. The Egyptian initiates wore the skin of a victim-representing Set. Thus, the overall symbolism of the new phase of the ritual probably refers to the achievement of a state in which one can undertake the symbolic crossing, thanks to which he will be qualified to become the leader, even after assuming certain powers related to the subterranean and vital dimension of the collective organism. The future king eventually reaches the other bank of the river and now must climb to the top of a mountain. Darkness surrounds him, but the gods help him to climb the path and to rise several levels. We notice here a recurrence of well-known symbols, the dry land or island, the mountain or the height. Moreover, we find the idea of planetary influences, the rings may correspond to the Platonic seven, wheels of destiny, that one must overcome by climbing all the way to the symbolic region of the fixed stars, which represent the states of the pure world of being. This corresponds to the passage from the lesser to the greater mysteries and to the old distinction between the lunar and telluric rite and the solar and Olympian rite. The person who is to be initiated is welcomed by other kings and by the highest dignitaries. He walks into an illuminated temple in order to establish contact with the divine. He is reminded to fulfill the main duties of a king. He finally receives the robes and the insignia of his dignity and sits on the throne. In Egypt, the rite of regal initiation included three separate moments corresponding to the above-mentioned phases. First came a purification. Then the rite of the reception of the supernatural fluid symbolized by the crown, aureus, or by the double crown. The crown was often called the great sorceress, who establishes at the right and at the left hand of the king the gods of eternity and of stability. And finally, the ascent to the temple representing the other world, Piduite, and the embrace of the Sor god, which was the definitive consecration that sanctified this new immortalizing birth and his divine nature, and by virtue of which the Egyptian king appeared as the son of the same god. The Eleusinian rite is one of the most complete rites of regal initiation. Allegedly, each of the symbols employed therein corresponded to a particular inner experience. Though at this time I do not intend to describe the means through which similar experiences were induced or what they were all about, I wish to emphasize that in the world of tradition, initiation in its highest forms was conceived as an intensely real operation that was capable of changing the ontological status of the individual and of grafting onto him certain forces of the world of being or of the overworld. The title of Rex in Greek, Basilis, at Eleusis testified to the acquired supernatural dimension that potentially qualified the function of the leader. The fact that at the time of the Eleusinian mysteries this title certainly did not go together with effective political authority was due to the decadence of ancient Helice. Because of this decadence, the ancient regal dignity was retained on a different plane than that of royal power, which by then had fallen into profane hands. This did not prevent temporal sovereigns in ancient times, however, from aspiring to achieve the dignity of an initiatory king, which was very different from the dignity that they actually enjoyed. Thus, for instance, when Hadrian and Antoninus were already Roman emperors, they received the title of king only after being initiated at Eleusis. According to concordant testimonies, the quality bestowed by initiation is distinct from and unrelated to any human merit. All of the human virtues combined could not produce this quality, just as, to a certain extent, no human sin could affect it. An echo of this notion was preserved in the Catholic view according to which the priestly dignity, which is transmitted sacramentally, cannot be effaced by any moral sin committed by the person endowed with it, since it remains in that person as an indelis indelebilis, and an indelible mark. You are a priest forever, Psalms 110:4. Moreover, as in the case of the Mysdean notion of Lori and of the Chinese notion of Urshu, the priestly dignity corresponded to an objective power. In ancient China, a distinction was made between those who were naturally endowed with knowledge and virtue, those who are capable of fulfilling heaven's law with calm and imperturbability and no help from the outside or at the pinnacle, and are perfected and transcended men, and those who achieved them by disciplining themselves and by returning to the rites. The discipline, siyuki, that is suitable to the latter men and that is the equivalent of initiation was considered only as a means to the real creation of that superior man, kyunsei, who could legitimately assume the function proper to the supreme hierarchical apex by virtue of the mysterious and real power inherent in him. The distinctive feature of what makes one a king is more evident when a consecration rather than an initiation occurs. For instance, only the characteristic special investiture that turns the already crowned Teutonic prince into the Roman Ormux can bestow upon him the authority and the title of leader of the Holy Roman Empire. Plato wrote, "In Egypt no king is allowed to rule without belonging to the priestly class. If by any chance a king of another race rises to power through violence, he eventually needs to be initiated into this class." Likewise, Plutarch wrote that, "A king chosen from among the warriors instantly became a priest and shared in the philosophy that is hidden for the most part in myths and stories that show dim reflections and insights of the truth. The same was true for the Parsis. It was precisely because the Persian great kings were elevated to the dignity of magi at the time of their enthronement and thus reunited the two powers that Iran did not experience conflicts or antagonisms between royalty and priesthood during the better period of its tradition." At the same time, it must be noted that traditionally, while those who had received the initiation were kings, the opposite was also true, namely, the fact that often the initiation and the priestly function itself were considered a prerogative of kings and of aristocratic caste. For instance, in the Homeric hymn to Demeter, the goddess allegedly restricted to the four Eleusinian princes and to their descendants the celebration of the cult and the knowledge of sacred orgies, by virtue of which, at if one does not incur the same fate as others. Ancient Rome struggled for a long time against the plebeian prevarication, and insisted that the priests of the higher collegii, and especially the Consuls, who originally enjoyed a sacred character themselves, were to be chosen only from patrician families. In this context, the need for a unitary authority was affirmed together with the instinctive acknowledgement that such an authority has a stronger foundation in those cases in which the race of the blood and the race of the spirit converge. Let us now examine the case of kings who have not been raised to a super-individual dignity through initiation, but rather through an investiture or consecration that is mediated by a priestly caste. This form is typical of more recent, historical times. The primordial theocracies did not derive their authority from a church or from a priestly caste. The Nordic kings were kings immediately by virtue of their divine origin, and just like the kings of the Dorocachine period, they were the only celebrants of sacrificial actions. In China, the emperor received his mandate directly from heaven. Until recently in Japan, the ritual of enthronement took place in the context of the individual spiritual experience of the emperor, who established contact with the influences of the regal tradition without the presence of an officiating clergy. Even in Greece and in Rome, the priestly collegii did not meet kings through the rites, but limited themselves to exercising the divinatory science in order to ascertain whether the person appointed to exercise the regal function was found pleasing to the gods. In other words, it was an issue of acknowledgement and not of investiture, as in the ancient Scottish tradition concerning the so-called Stone of Destiny. Conversely, at the origins of Rome, the priesthood was conceived as some kind of emanation of the primitive regality, and the king himself promulgated the laws regulating the cult. After Romulus, who was himself initiated to the divinatory art, Numa delegated the typically priestly functions to the Collegium of the Flaminus, which he himself instituted. At the time of the empire, the priestly body was again subjected to the authority of the Caesars, just like the Christian clergy later became subjected to the Byzantine emperor. In Egypt, until the 21st dynasty, the king delegated a priest, designated as the king's priest, Nodirhan, to perform the rites only sporadically, and the spiritual authority itself always represented a reflection of the royal authority. The Paleo-Egyptian Nodirhan parallels the role often played in India by the Purohita, who was a Brahmana employed at court and in charge of performing fire sacrifices. The Germanic races ignored consecration up to the Carolingian era. Charlemagne crowned himself, and so did Lodoicus and Pius, who later crowned his own son, Lodoric, without any direct involvement on the part of the Pope. The same holds true for the earlier forms of all traditional civilization, including the historical cycles of pre-Columbian America, and especially for the Peruvian dynasty of the Solar Masters or Incas. On the contrary, when a priestly caste or a church claims to be the exclusive holder of that sacred force that alone can empower the king to exercise his function, this marks the beginning of an involutive process. A spirituality that in and of itself is not regal, and conversely, a regality that is not spiritual, eventually emerge. This spirituality and this regality enjoyed separate existences. Also, Memon spirituality and a material virility began to coexist jointly with the lunar sacredness and a material solarity. The original synthesis, which corresponded to the primordial regal attribute of the glory or of the celestial fire of the conquerors, was dissolved and the plane of absolute centrality was lost. We shall see later on that such a split marks the beginning of the descent of civilizations in the direction that has led to the genesis of the modern world. Once the fracture occurred, the priestly caste portrayed itself as the caste in charge of tracting and transmitting spiritual influences, but without being capable of constituting their dominating center within the temporal order. This dominating center, instead, was virtually present in the quality of a warrior or nobleman of the king to whom the rite of consecration communicated these influences, the Holy Spirit in the Catholic tradition, so that he may assume them and actualize them in an efficient form. Thus, in more recent times, it is only through this priestly mediation and through a rites virtus deificans that the synthesis of the regal and priestly dimensions is reconstituted, a synthesis that is supposed to be the supreme hierarchical peak of a traditional social order. It is only in this way that the king again can be something more than a mere mortal. Likewise, in the Catholic ritual, the dress a king was supposed to wear before the rite of the investiture was simply a military dress. It is only in later times that a king began to wear the regal dress during the ceremony and began the tradition of sitting on an elevated place that had been reserved for him in the church. The rigorously symbolic meaning of the various phases of the ceremony has been preserved almost up to modern times. It is significant to find in older times the recurrent use of the expression regal religion, for which the enigmatic figure of Melchizedek was often evoked. Already in the Merovingian era, in reference to the king, we find the formula, Melchizedek noster, meritor ex aequo sacerdos. The king, who during the rite took off the dress that he previously put on, was believed to be one who leaves the mundane state in order to assume the state of regal religion. In AD 769, Pope Stephanus III reminded the Carolingians that they were a sacred race and a royal priesthood. Vos gens sancter estis, aeque regalis estis sacerdotum. Regal consecration was bestowed through anointing. Back in those times, this rite differed from the rite of consecration of bishops only in a few minor details, and therefore the king became as holy as a priest before men and God. Anointing, which belonged to the Jewish tradition and which was eventually taken up again by Catholicism, was the habitual rite employed to transfer a being from a profane into a sacred world. According to the Ghibelline ideal, it was thanks to his virtue that the consecrated person became a Deus Homo. Therefore, it was said that the king must stand out from the mass of lay people, since he participates in the priestly function by his having been anointed by consecrated oil. The anonymous author of York wrote, "The king, the Christ anointed of the Lord, cannot be regarded as being a layman." In the sporadic emergence of the idea that the rite of regal consecration has the power to erase every sin committed, including those that involve the shedding of blood, we find an echo of the above-mentioned initiatory doctrine concerning the transcendence of the supernatural quality vis a vis any human virtue or sin. In this chapter, I have discussed initiation in relation to the positive function of regality, even when considered in material terms. I have also mentioned instances in which the initiatory dignity separated itself from that function, or better, instances in which that function separated itself from the initiatory dignity by becoming secularized and by taking on a merely warrior or political character. Initiation must also be considered, however, as an independent category of the world of tradition without a necessary relation to the exercise of a visible function at the center of a society. Initiation, high-level initiation, not to be confused with initiation that is related to the regimen of the caste or to the traditional professions and the various artisan guilds, has defined, in and of itself, the action that determines an ontological transformation of man. High-level initiation has generated initiatory chains that were often invisible and subterranean, and that preserved an identical spiritual influence and an inner doctrine superior to the exoteric and religious forms of a historical tradition. There are even instances in which the initiate has enjoyed this distinct character in a normal civilization, and not only during the ensuing period of degeneration and inner fracture of the traditional unity. This character has become necessary and all-pervasive, especially in Europe in these latter times, because of the involutive processes that have led both to the organization of the modern world and to the advent of Christianity. Hence the merely initiatory character of the Hermetic Rex, of the Rosicrucian Emperor, and so on.